snow in a rented minivan. To Ohio I go for Penguin Live with Dan. This show is off the chain, full of songs and jokes and dance. This evening so incredible, I might just soil my pants. Penguin Live, do it every year. Making fun of magic crap and spreading Christmas cheer. Hey! Raise your glass, hold it high, fill it to the brim. Time to take the magic world and point out stuff that's grim. Making fun of magic and shitting on Shin Lim. The air is crisp and bright, the Yule log's by the fire. My skinny jeans are tight, which makes my balls perspire. Penguin Live, thanks for tuning in. Got a lot of stuff to do, just can't wait to begin. Hey, Penguin Live, you're happy as can be. 'Cause if you signed up early, then you got this shit for free. They say you get what you pay for, and we hope that you'll agree. Penguin Live, Osterlin should know. It's way more entertaining than a mentalism show. Hey, Penguin Live, no PC protocols. Time to roast some chestnuts and to deck them in the halls. And if you're offended, you can kiss my cups and balls. Hey!
The Penguin Live Spectacular Holiday and Magic Extravaganza is brought to you by Sharpies that shoot fire out of them. If you're a magic company, jump on the bandwagon and put out another Sharpie that shoots fire out of it. The perfect gift for 40-year-olds who still live in their mom's basement. And by the new Deer Nuts deck by the Buck Twins. The most inexpensive cardistry deck you can buy. That's right. Beer nuts are $4.95, but deer nuts are under a buck. And now, please welcome your host, Scott Alexander.
Hey! Thank you. Thank you. It's great to be here. Welcome back to the sixth and final Penguin Spectacular Holiday and Magic Extravaganza. I know, but we can't do this forever. So, you can always go back on the interwebs and relive the magic and the mystery. But, let us not fret, for we have much magic to get to. I would like to start off with my work on a brand new trick that has come out. He shared this with me, and I'm going to share it with you before anyone else gets to it. This is actually the Dirk Losander Floating Pot of Flowers. It's amazing. It floats all about and dances just like the table, just like the other table, just like the other table, and the other table, and all of the tables. But finally, we've got a pot of flowers that's going to dance and float all around. It's going to be amazing. Watch this one, and I'll teach my work on it. It's really great. Oh, shit. Well, there goes $2,000. All right. Damn it.
To officially start the show. So please silence all cell phones. Silence anything that rings. Anything that. There you go. That's what you should be doing. All right, let me tell you about this thing. This is the first trick. This is something I've used in every Christmas show I've ever done. It's a great way to get people to silence their cell phones. It's a bell that automatically stops ringing. Super easy to make. This is a Walmart special. So you go to Walmart and you go into their housewares section into the bathroom area where they have all of the various cups for your toothbrushes and things like that and soap dishes and such, and you will find these metal cups. So from that part up, this is a metal cup you can get at any Walmart. Then you go over to the office supply and you buy a highlighter. You know, pretty much any marking pen that's got a straight barrel like this. And what you do is you remove all the guts from the highlighter. You take the bottom out of it. You take all of the felt and the nib and all that kind of stuff. And then you mount the highlighter into a hole that you've drilled into that cup. Then cover it You can also get this, in their in the hardware section. This is contact paper, wood grain contact paper. So you just mount that in there. Now you're going to take, a shoelace. So you can go over there again into the shoelace section and get that. Double it over. Two strands go in, but only one strand comes out. So you're going to hot glue it together so that it makes about that long, and then one strand extends to the inside, and then you have to find a bell clapper. And that bell clapper can be just about anything. You can actually take that out from a regular bell and look how it's attached to that one strand. If you pull on the string, it goes into the cap of the highlighter in which you have drilled a hole. So it's super duper easy. It just pops right into there like that. So you start out with it around your wrist like this. And as long as it's loose, it'll make noise. And then all you do is just push a little forward. It goes right into the cap and you've silenced the bell.
Yeah. Nice. If you didn't find a bell clapper, you could get a fishing weight or something. That would be just as cool to use. Yeah, cool. All right. Well, now I know everyone loves mentalism. Oh, good. You're pumped.
How did you know?
How did you know? Good. So I thought I would do a little mental piece for you. I have written something down on this gigantic card. I'm going to save it for later. But this is not a mentalism piece that's dry and stale like a book test or anything like that. This is about a trip to the beach. Ladies and gentlemen, I remember fondly my folks taking me to the beach. And often on the beach, we know there is quite a bit of sand. I collected some sand in this particular jar here, and I'm going to pour some of that sand out onto this piece of paper. I have measured the exact quantity of sand that is necessary for this, and that should be enough. Now it says, wise men say that there are more grains of sand, or more stars in the cosmos than every grain of sand on every beach in the entire world. Amazing. And we've only tapped a very small portion of the brain. But I'm going to try to take you on a little journey to the beach and see if you can help me determine exactly what's going on here. So I'd like you, sir, what is your name?
Dan.
Dan. I'm going to write down the number one because there are 100,000 grains of sand I've tempered out here onto that piece of paper. What I'd like you to do is to take the pad, take the pencil, and after that one, I'd like you to write a two-digit number, but not yet. I'm going to send it to you into the middle of your brain. Are you ready? Write down the first two-digit number that comes to you right after that one. Once you've done that, I'd like you to put a comma, because now you're going to think of a three-digit number. I'm going to send it to you now. Write down any three-digit number following that comma. Nicely done. Let's take a look and see how you did. Oh, pretty good, but you were off by two. Not bad. Not bad. All right.
So close.
Now, the second portion of sand I shall also pour out, also about 100,000 grains of sand, give or take. Whoop, sorry. One too many. There we go. All right. I'm going to also write a one underneath this, and if you wouldn't mind helping me, what is your name?
Sophia.
Would you also take the pad,
yes.
And would you, next to the one, write a two-digit number? Not yet. I'm going to send it to you now. Any two-digit number after that second one. Once you're finished, put a comma. And now I'm going to send you a three-digit number. Get ready for it. Two digits are the same in this number. Write it down now. Very good. Let's see how you did.
Oh,
that's all right. You'll get it. Thanks. Right?
Oh,
off by one. Off by one. I shouldn't have put that one back. All right. Now the rest of the sand. Each and every grain of sand from the bottle. And I'm going to ask you, sir, what is your name?
Rick.
Also, I'm going to put a one here. After that, I'd like you to put a two-digit number. I'm sending it to you now. Place a two-digit number. Then place a comma. Once you've done that, three-digit number. Have you got it?
Got it.
Perfect. Now, someone who hasn't helped me yet, maybe somebody in the back, does anyone have a phone that has a calculator on it? We're going to do some math. Do you have a phone?
Yep.
I'm going to toss you the pad. I want you to take the pad, open it up, and I'd like you to type in the first number, that first 100,000 number into your calculator. Let me know when you've done that.
Okay.
Got it?
Yep.
Now, hit plus, type in the second number, and continue with the third number. While you're doing that, it's interesting to know, if you listen to the bottle here, you can hear the ocean. Listen. You got it? Okay, good. Oh, you got it added up already. Oh, good.
How many people got the joke?
You didn't get the joke. That's right. That's too many damn millennials in here. All right. Billy Ocean, we love him. I'm going to put all the sand back inside. Yes, that was Billy Ocean in case we... Oh, God damn it. All right. Sorry, close enough. All right, well, close enough. Okay. Mentalism is not an exact science, ladies and gentlemen, I'll tell you. Would you please announce the total that you got? What was it?
577,345. So 577,345.
Thank you. Your attention to detail is appreciated. Toss the bat back. Read that number out loud once again to everybody.
577,345.
577,345. You folks did a great job. Okay. But we all know we don't go to the beach to collect sand. We go to the beach to collect other things. Not sand. No. We go to the beach to collect shells. And I don't know how you did it or how you knew it, but that's exactly what I predicted.
Burn him! He's a witch!
So I really like this trick. It's mentalism, but it's mentalism that can relate to things. And you could even expand the story and talk about when you went to the beach with your parents when you were a kid. And I like it because it delivers three wow moments at the end. On my DVDs that I put together, the stand-up show, I talk about the rule of three and how you have to hit them three times to really get it going. And this is the perfect example of hitting them three times. It's an add a number routine. Another cool thing about this is I'm using a new thing that's coming out. It'll be out. This is going to be airing at the end of December, so this is going to be out in January or February, but it's a great add a number pad, and this is a locking add a number pad, but it's a locking add a number pad that uses post-it notes. So you can easily replace your numbers inside this leather case using post-it notes, and it locks. So it locks all the information away that you don't want them to see and reveals your information. I had this actually made by the prototype was made by a leather guy who builds badge holders and holsters for like CIA guys and for FBI guys. So it's just a really cool thing, and it fits in your pocket, and it's really small, and it's not like the Kozar pad that takes forever to change paper out. It's a really thing. You'll use this thing all the time. So that's coming out. But if you already have an add a number routine, if you're using one of these Kozar pads or any of the other methods, Michael Lamar has one in his lecture, that's basically the whole thing that this is based on. So what you're doing is you have a prearranged set of numbers, and I have them here, and I'll give them to you now just so you know what they are. The numbers that I use are 189,555, 199,874, and 187,916. And that adds up to this total, which when flipped upside down spells shells. So what you need to do is get a prediction card, write that number, and I usually trace it in pencil first so I can kind of make sure it looks like when it's upside down it's shells, and then I just trace over the pencil, making it look as much like shells as I can, but also keeping in mind that people, we don't want it to get ahead of us, so it should look as much like a number as it can as well. This prop is actually a Niffin tube. It's very cool. These are being made again. Penguin has them on their site. But a Niffin tube basically has a compartment for, and I use this on my second Penguin special for another trick, but basically the shells are in this side and the sand is in this side. So yeah, isn't that cool? So it's a really clever little gimmick. And the rest of this is pretty much just acting. So once you have the people write down whatever numbers they're going to write down, and you switch them using your add a number principle, or my pad, which I call the bias pad, by the way, And I call it the bias pad because you're biased towards one side of the information, right? Yours. So you switch the numbers and you have them add up your prearranged set of numbers, which I already gave you, which will add up to this total. And then step number one, you reveal the number prediction. That gets you one round of applause. You reveal that the sand has transformed into the shells, which gets you your second round of applause. And then you hit them one more time with flipping it upside down, and that gets you your third round of applause. And I think it's a wonderful little piece of mentalism. So there you go.
Thank you so much. That's our show. No. It's that time of year again. Scott has once again released his timeless Christmas album with K-Tel Records. It's a magical friggin' Christmas. Volume 6! Oh, 6 years. Look, here's Scott croon his original timeless classics like this one that is dedicated to this year's winner of America's Got Talent.
Shin Lim, Shin Lim, AGT, he did win. He fooled the judges galore by ditching his props on the floor.
There you go. That's
even my 8-year-old said, "Why is he throwing shit on the floor?
Why is he done?" Since the success of Derek Delgadio's In and of Itself, there is a new wave of one-man shows popping up all over the country. So, in honor of this new trend, Scott has penned a new Christmas classic.
The one-man show, yes. I got an idea, ding-dang-do. I'll put on a one-man show. Magicians glom onto trends, you know, so I'll do a show like Delgadio. Ho, 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 no one will know. Ho, 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 I'll be a ho. 6 impossible things, you know, is pretty much Diet Delgadio.
And here is Scott's little ditty for all those billiard ball manipulators out there.
Look at my balls, sweet billiard balls, all seem to say I'm sort of gay. Manipulate, man, this is great, but I can't forget, need a new set. Ding dong, ding dong. What should it be? Maybe Fakini, possibly Von Lee. I gotta see, these are tacky, they stick to me. Son of a beach, they smell like bleach. Climbing the walls, buy me more balls, order them, mom, penguin.com. Buy me billiard balls for Christmas.
Oh, God. I seriously hope none of you are following along with the drinking game. The smash and stab plot is very popular in magic, but lots of magicians have injured themselves because they're using, dumb things. They're using methods that involve real sharp objects. So here's Scott's plea to get everyone to practice safe smashing and stabbing.
Now Russian roulette's quite exciting. Most magicians all find it inviting. It's all fun and grand till you stab through your hand and end up looking like a dickhead. A lot of the methods are clever, but remember to never say never. If something sharp's in the bag, you will find it a drag when you end up bleeding out on the front row. Now Penn Jillette says, lest we all forget, and one day you'll regret and fuck the whole thing up. Don't be a schmuck and don't rely on luck. My versions do not suck. Your safety's guaranteed. Now if you do my nailed it or shattered, well then I would sincerely be flattered. And you won't be a boob and end up on YouTube looking like a dumb pathetic wanker. There's Pain Game and Scorpion and T2, but they all have you risk saying me too. Don't be a hack, cause Scott's got your back. Just go by my nailed it or shattered. So listen to me if it pleases, cause you don't want to end up like Jesus. Don't be a turd, just go take my word and purchase my nailed it or shattered. There is a chance that all the best laid plans will leave you with your pants all down around your knees. It's all your fault, so if you're worth your salt, you don't want your show to come to a halt, so all listen to me. So when you perform, you can have fun, and you'll never risk hitting the wrong one. Don't be a cheap prick, just go by my trick, and you will be safer in the long run.
Woo!
Yeah. Thank
you. Ole!
Ole!
And speaking of classics, we always include a re-recording of this crowd-pleasing favorite. Sing along, everybody, if you know the words.
Oh, yeah. In fact, he was just here, wasn't he?
Yep.
Not too long ago?
Yeah.
Tune in live for this one.
Danny De Ortiz. Danny De Ortiz. Danny De Ortiz, Juan Tamariz, and Rene Levan. Danny De Ortiz, and Oscar Muniz, and Hector Ruiz, Juan Tamariz, Woody Aragon.
They always tell you to shuffle, shuffle. They always tell you to shuffle, shuffle. They always tell you to shuffle, shuffle, cause they're seeking as a fart. Hey!
Woo! So, don't walk. Run. Run to purchase your very own copy of It's a Magical Freaking Christmas, available at Walmart and wherever booze and guns are sold.
Hey! All right. Now it's time for a card trick.
Yay!
All right. So let's have someone pick a card. Would you mind and just reach in there and take a card? They're all different, right? Blah, blah, all that stuff. Take one out. All right. Perfect.
Save a lot of time if they were all the same.
Save a lot of time, really. Show it around, let everybody see it, put it back, all that stuff. Perfect, good. You know how to do all this. All right, so we're going to shuffle it up. Because this is not about the card. It's about finding the card. What it is doesn't matter. You remember your card. Some folks saw the card. All right, here's what we're going to do. I'm going to try to find the card, but I'm going to try to find the card in a very dangerous way because most card tricks are pretty namby-pamby. But this particular card trick is going to be dangerous. Ooh. Done with this spring steel animal trap. Using for trapping steel animals. I don't know what that's for. But... Now, this thing is really dangerous. I'm going to try and set it. I'm kind of a little tentative about this because I did have caught my finger in it before. It's meant to trap animals. It closes. Oh, God, that's tough. It closes at approximately the velocity of 350 pounds of pressure per square inch. I shall now demonstrate the power of the awesome jaws of this trap by using this Vietnamese bamboo. Now, I know a lot of you wonder, why do they call it bamboo? Well, because when you do this, it goes, BAMBOO! Oh! I almost stuck my finger in there. All right, so you can see that's pretty powerful and very dangerous. I'm going to reset it and try and defy pain and discomfort itself. by finding your card while it's balanced upon the steel trap. Now, to make it a little bit more difficult for myself, I'm going to blindfold the deck. Using this ordinary, old, wrinkly paper sack. All right. The cards go inside the bag. The bag balances precariously on the trap itself. Oh! That was close. I'll try it again. A hair trigger can set off the trap at any moment. Very dangerous.
And Scott, I'd like to say, don't do it, but I won't because I want to see you do it.
All right. I'm going to give this a try. All right. Balance precariously on the trap. You remember your card? Risking life and limb to find your card. To look through the pack, find the exact card. Oh! Was that your card?
No.
Was that your card?
No.
God damn it. Hold on. Do you see something you like? Anything? All right, hold on. What was your card?
Six of clubs.
Six of clubs? Oh, darn. Hold on, I can't let that stay there. Son of a bitch! So as you can see, that's a pretty damn funny trick. I love this trick. I use it on certain occasions. I perform at a Renaissance festival a lot. I've used that for that. It's based on a couple things. A lot of guys have versions of this steel trap. It's really cool. I mean, this steel trap is awesome because you can set it. And I mean, if you have enough hand strength, you can set it without having to step on it. But it's much easier if you step on it. But basically, this is really just meant to trap an animal. It's just meant to grab. So you can stick your hand in there and it doesn't do anything. It just grabs you. But to the audience, it really provides a hell of a lot of stuff. These, Abbott's makes these. You probably can even get them on Penguin, I wouldn't imagine. But it's just a regular animal trap. Small animal trap. You can find at the animaltrap.com. I don't know. Lonnie, Sherry, a bunch of people have versions of this. But every version I've seen, you actually do it in front of people. You see it clamping down. And the thing that I started thinking about was that's too graphic. And I always think of Alfred Hitchcock, right? In the shower scene, you never see the knife go into Janet Lee, right? You see the curtains pull, you see the knife moving, you see the chocolate syrup in the bathtub swirling around, but you never see the moment. And that lets your mind kind of create the danger and the drama. And as you noticed, when it happened, you guys were filling in the blanks mentally of what the hell happened inside the bag. So I think the idea of using the bag makes it that much more dramatic and interesting, right? Rather than just, he snapped his hand. I started working on this routine when I saw Harry Anderson's book, Wise Guy. He had a thing in there where he would have a stopwatch, and on the back of the stopwatch, it would say, when I say, when did my pulse stop, you say it didn't, right? So he would set the trap, give it to her, have her hold the wrist, and then stick his hand in it and say, okay, when did my pulse stop? And she would go, it didn't. And he would go, ah, son of a bitch, you know, and then he would do that. And so I thought that was great. And then I said, well, okay, well, how can I make this even better? So basically, I'll walk through it, and then I'll talk about the ending, too, which is really funny. So first of all, basically, you set the trap, right? And the trap works on its own. You can really stick, it's tentative to stick your hand in there. But the nice thing about the paper bag is, if you do it, and the reason I crushed the paper bag is because if you try and do this and have it slam shut on the paper bag itself, it doesn't really close all that great on the paper bag if you don't smush it a little bit. You almost have to have it a little wrinkly and loose to do it. Because if you just put a paper bag on there, even the bag stops it, you know, a lot of times, especially with a deck of cards in there. So the idea is you, of course, force a card, you bring the card to the top, you control it. When I go to put the deck in the bag, I simply top palm the card after I controlled it to the top, and I just put a big crimp in it and just leave it sitting on top of the deck so I can find it. It's just sitting right there on top, easy to find. So my hand goes in the bag, I balance the trap definitely there, and I actually like to let it go off once to make it look like a mistake so it creates more danger. And all you have to do is push down lightly and it'll close. So then I go in and I get the card in my palm and I get ready and I just, boom, shove it down and the trap closes, okay? Now, acting, oh God, and it creates a drama. Then I take the other bag and I inflate it and I blow some air into it and say, this gag is actually from Steve Martin. He used to do an act where he would blow up balloon animals. And he'd say, I like to blow up balloons and put words in them. So when they pop, they go, God damn it. Right? So that's where that idea came from. That's where that idea came from. So you do that, you shove it in there, you let it close on the palm of your hand, and then you milk it. You pull out one card, tear the bag a little bit, throw it, tear the bag, throw it, rip the whole bag off your hand, which creates another dramatic situation. Show the palm of your hand, the card is snapped there. Wow, great ending. But then you've got that wonderful comedy blow off when you go, God damn it! You know, and it gets a really big round of applause. So I should explain how that, when I snapped the spring trap, it went boing, 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 and all that stuff. What you need is some spaghetti. I actually learned this from a couple guys I worked at the Renaissance Festival with. They did a whip cracking act, and they actually told me, and I watched them do this, when they crack the whips, they use this spaghetti, and it creates a nice big display of stuff going all over the place. So what you need to do is take some spaghetti, uncooked spaghetti, take some tape, and about an inch down from the top, just wrap some spaghetti around that. Right? Wrap some tape around that spaghetti. At the other end, wrap some tape around the spaghetti. And the nice thing about the spaghetti is that when the spring trap closes on it, it goes everywhere. It looks really dramatic. When other people usually do the spring trap, they use like a pretzel or a pencil that you have to pre-break and then re-break again. But I really wanted something that would kind of go everywhere and look really chaotic. And when I saw the guys doing this in their whip cracking act, I asked them, I said, do you mind if I use this? And they said, no, go for it. So basically what you do is you use that, you wrap your spaghetti up, you set your spring trap to the way you get it to snappy snappy. So once you set that, as soon as you put this spaghetti into the spring trap, it just goes everywhere, and it looks so much more dramatic when you do it. So if you watch really carefully, you'll actually see that it goes bam, and it really looks quite impressive. So that's my take on the daring spring trap. So there you go.
So, Scott, now it is time to head to the internets.
Ah, yes, the internets, my favorite.
We're going off to the internets for a segment that we all know and love. Well, all right, we all know it.
We all know it. We
don't know it. Memes for magicians.
Memes for magicians.
Oh, yeah. It's memes for magicians. Memes for magicians. They're memes, but they're just for magicians. magicians. Memes for magicians.
So here's our first entry from Memes for Magicians, a wonderful website by V. Sparrow on the World Wide Web, so on the Facebook. This says, from Mario Carsatis, my girlfriend walked in when my magic buddies and I were talking about strippers. Always fun there.
Oh, you know, it's especially bad with the belly strippers.
They got questions and they're mad. And they're mad, yes, yes. This one comes from Jaroslaw Ray, Juan Claude Van Damme.
Okay, go on.
All right, so there you go. All right, not as funny as we thought going to be. Right. This is from Corey Van Allen. Why does Melania Trump always look like she's trying to bend spoons with her mind?
Yeah.
She does. Okay. This one's from Carissa Hendricks. My actual face when practicing coins across. I think we've all been there.
Yep.
All right. This one is from Mark Rosbach. Jean-Luc, pick a card, any card. All right. This is from Kevin Cunlife. Yo, wizard, motherfucker. That's Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah.
This is from Daniel Mancini. Forgetful Freddie Mercury.
It's all right.
I thought it was
funny.
I'd like
to actually see it.
Yeah, I'd like to see
it.
I'd like to build the prop. Yeah, I did build one.
Did you build a forgetful Freddie Mercury? Yeah.
And I think from now on, all silk fountains should be referred to. This one's from me.
Yep.
I think all silk fountains from now on should be referred to as the exploding rainbow cabbage. And that's memes for magicians,
everybody. It's memes for magicians. Memes for magicians. They're memes, but they're just for magicians. Memes for magicians.
All right. This is not just your run-of-the-mill kind of a trick. I'm actually going to introduce you to a strange creature that I have been fortunate enough to discover living out in the wilds. This is a young lady who was raised by a coven of rabid squirrels. And I have brought her into captivity. And they've released her from her containment unit back there. So please, everyone, welcome Lucy, the Wild Wonder Girl. Lucy, come on out. Come on out, Lucy. Come on. No, it's okay. It's okay. Everybody here is friends. No, put the cabbage down. Come here, Lucy. Lucy, yeah. Heel. Good. Good girl. Your hair's a little musk. All right. Now, the interesting thing about Lucy is that even though she was raised in the wild and, we have domesticated her, she does have the ability to perform some amazing things. She can't communicate in the standard way, but she does perfect impressions of any animal in the entire world. Lucy, we're gonna do an impression, okay? Lucy, donkey. Lucy, a horse. Right, Lucy, pay attention. A wolf. Perfect. Spot on impressions. Now, what's interesting about this is that we have trained her on animal crackers. She can identify them just by the sound of the animal cracker that the animal cracker makes. I'm gonna get some. Hey, what's your name?
Steve,
come on up here, Steve. Steve, come on up here. Okay, so Steve, here, look, I'm gonna reach into the animal crackers and I'm gonna just take one at random. Can you identify that animal?
Yes.
All right, good. Now, Lucy. Listen to this animal cracker. You ready? Ready? All right. When she hears it, she'll be able to mimic the sound that this animal makes. So listen, everybody. Moo, it's a cow, yes? A cow? Here, take a look at that. It's a cow. Yeah, she got it right. Lucy, here you go. Here you go. Yeah, good girl. Should have spent more time with her. All right, so here's what I'd like you to do. I want you to put on these sanitary gloves there for your protection more than anything else. And as you put the sanitary gloves on, we're going to mix up the remainder of the animal crackers here, because what you're going to do is you're going to snap off one. She not only can recognize them by the sound that they make when they break, she can also recognize them by tasting just a tiny little piece of each and every one of them. Have you ever eaten one of these?
Yes.
They're awful.
Yes.
Okay, good. Oh, no, Lucy, no. All right, so just reach in there, grab anyone that you want, anyone at all. Don't say what it is, but look at it. Can you identify what that one is? Do you know what it is? Just take your time with it, because some of these are a little weird. You got an idea? You're pretty sure you know what it is? Yep. All right, so just break off a foot. Just break off a foot, okay? And then carefully approach Lucy. Carefully approach Lucy and feed her just the foot of the thing. A goat! Is it a goat? Is it? Show everybody, it's a goat. You can feed her the rest of it. Go ahead, you can feed her the rest of that animal cracker. Now, not only that, she is so tuned in to these that she can identify them just by scent alone. So reach in there and take any one that you want, take it out. Hold it in your closed, first of all, can you identify that one?
Yes.
Hold it in your closed fist, and then approach Lucy to let her sniff your fist. There it is! Is it an elephant? Show everybody! She got the elephant. Go ahead and feed it to Lucy. There you go. You've done a good job. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for helping. Everybody, Lucy, the wild wonder girl. Oh all right. All right. This whole ridiculous little skit depends a lot on the person that plays Lucy, the Wild Wonder Girl. All it is a matter of remembering just three basic impressions. Now, we added the little extra bit at the top where she says bray, nay, and hey, which I think is a pretty funny joke to begin with. But the other thing is, it's a triple forcing bag that you can use to force the animal crackers. Really super, super easy to make. So you got to find yourself a big bag of animal crackers. And in fact, you're going to have to probably buy two bags of these because you're going to have to sort them all out. Now, I don't know if you ever looked at these things, but most of them you can't identify at all. They're blobs. You're like, that's an animal blob. I have no idea what that thing is. So you throw those away. You throw away all the broken ones. Actually, the truth is, you put them in a dish and you feed them to your audience, which is what we did to you. So the other thing, you're looking for animals that somebody can do an impression of pretty easily, and you'll find at least three. You've got to find at least three, and then pick the three that you like so that they kind of build in interest. Now, I will tell you that the three that we picked, the cow, the goat, and the elephant, are pretty good. The goat's a little weird to identify, but we didn't have many options as far as what that goes. But I'll also tell you that in the past when I've done this, I've had my wild girl do an impression of a giraffe. I know a giraffe doesn't make a lot of... You want to do a giraffe?
I'm good.
Okay, do you remember it?
Yep.
It doesn't make a lot of noise, but...
Would
but
you like
here's,
to see the impression?
Yeah. Giraffe, yeah.
Would you like to hear what a giraffe sounds like?
Yeah, here we go. Right? Here's a giraffe.
Like to hear it. Here it goes.
Yep. There you go. There you go. So there's a couple of details that can be added to that, but that's all that has to be done. They're down here and they go like that, right? And you say, it must have something with a long neck. What is it? And they say giraffe, and it's funny. But you can also do this. Scott actually added this just before the show, if we had a giraffe, because I told him about this trick. he added this, which I think is hilarious. Ah! Which I think is hilarious. I think that's so giraffe, right?
Comedy gold.
Right?
Comedy gold.
Right? It's good, right? I've also had the wild girl do an impression of a bunny, you know, just hopping around the stage, right? It doesn't have to make a noise. You just have to be able to recognize it. Monkeys are good. There were no monkeys in this particular thing, but monkey is very good, you know.
Monkey bunny.
Monkey bunny. So the idea is to find three that are very interesting that you can also identify. And then here's how you make the forcing bag. So this is all there is to it. It's really, really easy. Super, super easy. So I have two Ziploc bags that have been stapled together, back to back or front to front, however it is. And then on them, I have written in reverse here. Goat on this one. Now, the reason it's in reverse is because I'm looking onto the inside, so I'm seeing it written properly here. When you open these up inside there, you won't see the outside of it. You'll see the inside of it, so you know that that's the goat side. And then here, elephant's written in reverse, so you know it's the elephant. So in this bag are all goats. That's it. And in this bag, there are all elephants. And then at the bottom of this are all cows. That's it. There's just a bunch of cows in the bottom. So these go into here so that when I reach in to pull out the first one, I just go past the bags, pull out one from the bottom, and I am going to get a cow. That's simple. And then from that point on, I just have to open the right bag, look inside, and it says goat. There it is right there. And then my spectator is going to reach in there and pull out the goat. And then, of course, we go to the other bag. They pull out the elephant. And that's it. That is Lucy, the wild wonder girl. Oh, yeah. So now it's time for one of our favorite segments. It's Holiday Magic with Scott and Dan.
It's that time again, so please welcome two fellas who are sure to jingle your bells and mistle your toes. It's Holiday Magic with Scott and Dan.
Hey, gang, I'm Scott.
And I'm Dan. Yeah.
And this is Holiday Magic with Scott and Dan.
It's us. Now, this year, we have a whole bunch of great ideas, right, for magical holiday comings and goings.
You know, Dan, who doesn't love beef and cheese?
Oh, I'm telling you, I love it. there's nothing like the pungent smell of beef and cheese during the holidays.
Yes, and we're not just referring to Aunt Lorraine's thighs rubbing together.
That's not bad, too. You know, hey, didn't Aunt Lorraine get some new breast implants? Those helium-filled breast implants, right?
Why, yeah. Yes, she did. Yes,
she did. Yeah. And, what did your uncle think of those?
He said, wow, they're great.
Well, speaking of beef and cheese, we have these new delightful treats in honor of America's Got Talent winner, Shin Lim.
That's right. This holiday season, you can serve this festive holiday treat. Make up a batch of our Shin Lim Slim Jims. Ooh. Yeah, these are delicious sticks of spicy Asian beef wrapped in an American cheese vest, topped off with an adorable cotton candy hairdo.
Oh, let me have a little bit of this one.
Yeah.
Mmm.
Oh, yeah.
Mmm. They taste like $1 million.
Well, 300,000 after taxes.
Now, and here we have our Danny Garcia tapah.
Yes, tapah. It's baby shrimp with a shaved head of lettuce. a touch of peppermint, all served up in a little tiny mint box. Isn't that cute?
I'm not eating that.
Don't eat the shrimp.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. That's not good.
Yeah, okay. Now, the next one is somebody that everybody knows.
I know, speaking of treats, how about Chris Angel?
He's yummy.
Isn't he, right? Well then, you'll love our Chris Angel Devil's Food Cake.
That's a nice play. I would have thought Angel Food Cake, you went the other way.
I know. Nice. The sad part is you can't get it at the Luxor anymore.
Ooh, I'm gonna have a little bite though.
Good stuff, huh? Don't tweak your mind.
Tastes like old tattoos. Now, all right. How about this for a holiday treat?
Oh, these are special. These are.
Yeah, this is Luna Shimada's Mystery Muffins.
Yeah.
They're made with earth, air, flour, and water.
Yeah, and that's real dirt in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, have some.
A hint of patchouli oil.
Yeah, have some.
Yeah,
eat
have,
it.
Yeah,
eat
some.
It, Scott.
Mm, so good.
It smells like mystery school in here already.
Yeah. So good. So good. Here, have some of those. Those are really good.
Yeah,
those
enjoy some mystery
muffins.
You're
going to want those.
Yeah. There you go. There's the.
Oh, yeah. Here's our final treat. It's the Tony Slidini Big Italian Sausage Pizza.
Wow, that's a nice looking sausage.
Yeah, you want some mustard with that?
Sure.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Throw in a gag if you like. Throw in a gag if you like. But I'm gonna make a disapizza, a disappear.
You're not gonna toss it over my head, are you? I know that one.
No, I'm not. Even better. Watch this. Ready? The whole pizza's gonna disappear. A one, a two, a
where did it go? Where is it, Scott?
Oh.
Where the what?
I bring it back!
Come on!
Look at that! That's so good! That's so good! Wait a minute.
Wait,
you know,
there's
got
to be more
than
just the meal. There has to be more to the holiday festivities than just the meal.
When you serve these, you got to do this.
Oh, yeah. I forgot.
That's much better, see?
Now, there you go.
There, see?
Oh, that's chicken liverific.
Now, here's a little holiday tip for you. I mean, you know what?
Nothing better than secondhand vape.
Oh, secondhand vape. You know, so let's move on to our holiday tip section. I mean, how many times has this happened to you? You try and wrap a package, right?
Mm-hmm.
And wouldn't you know it, the darn wrapping paper keeps rolling up on itself.
It happens all the time to me. Now, what do we do about that?
Well, rather than tell them, why don't we show them?
I think we should.
Yeah. We need to have somebody come up and help
right.
out with this.
Who can we get?
Since you're down front, would you mind helping me with this?
There you go.
Sure, come on up. This is great.
You're going to help. This is such an easy
So sit down right here
wrapping.
on the table. Sit
there
down
you
and
go.
Hold
you have
that.
Good. See, that's
and
the middle part, but the ends. We got to take care of the ends.
Yeah. So put your feet down this
there
end
you
and
go.
Your head down that end.
That's it. Gently, gently.
Yeah, gently.
This way, gently,
all
gently.
All the way down there.
Relax, relax.
And scooch this way a little bit.
Scooch a little bit. So, yeah, there you
good.
Go.
Yeah. See?
All right, perfect.
See, now the paper.
Here's a pillow.
Oh, yeah, give her a pillow.
Comfortable.
Actually, here, sit up for a second, because we don't want you, it looks uncomfortable.
Yeah.
We're
going
to put the special supine, supine lumbar support.
The lumbar support, you must
supine,
have it.
You have to have the lumbar support.
Put it right there. That's
right there.
Perfect.
Now, this will be
there
much more comfortable
All
for you.
Right,
go ahead,
right
lay down
this
right
way.
On that.
Yeah, yeah.
So much better.
There
see?
You go.
Already.
You can enjoy the entire show in this position. There
now,
is
we don't want you to roll off
perfect.
The table.
Oh, yeah. So we're going to lock them in place.
We're going to put this over top. Just to lock everything
there
in place.
There you go. More comfortable.
Good. Now take your hands.
Safety, security, comfort, everything.
Take your hands and cross them like this. That'll save time later.
There you go. When
okay,
we,
good.
When, when we call the authorities about the body.
So now you take one of these. This
oh,
is
by
from
the way, what's your name? Sophia. Just so I can fill out the form.
Yeah, you gotta fill out the form.
All right, Sophia.
So now we put Sophia into the hypnotic trance. So go like this.
All right, yep.
All right, and ready, and sleep.
That's it.
But she's out like a light.
There you go.
Look at that.
Yep.
That's good.
Yep.
Now we're going to take this. This is an actual bow saw by the Wellington Saw and Lumberjack Company.
Looks sharp.
I know. It very is. Would you like to test that out?
Oh,
Wow.
That's pretty sharp, yeah. Mm-hmm. Whose motto is, you cut down one tree, it doesn't make you a lumberjack. Okay, so we're going to put that right there, down inside, and we'll close that up. Now take one hand and put it on each one. Get a grip on yourself.
I didn't like that. I didn't like that at all.
Now, go ahead and hug yourself again. Hug yourself again.
Relax, Sophia.
All right. Now what we're going to do is we're going to cut the wrapping paper. We're going to cut Sophia in half without cutting the wrap. No, wait, sorry.
Wait, no, we're going to cut the wrapping paper in half and not cut Sophia in half.
And
now's a bad time to ask, yeah. But, you know, or at least to tell you, I'm not sure what to do here. I don't understand how this. Let's just cut.
Okay, yeah, let's just cut. Back and forth, back and forth.
There we go.
All the way there.
That one out there, okay.
And now you'll notice it actually cut right through these pieces of wood that are
what
in there.
What is going on with the
wood?
But
hopefully it left you okay. How you doing, Sophia?
You all right?
So far, so good.
Okay, good. Yeah. So far, so what? Now, we're going to open this up and remove these pieces here, hopefully.
Just stay there.
Everything will be fine because I think you healed up too quickly.
Okay. All right. Gently sit up.
Gently sit up. And as you can see, that kind of cut all the way through your body. Raise your arms up in the air. We'll take that off like a t-shirt. Everybody give Sophia a big round of applause.
Nice job!
Yes! Oh. And the best part is the wrapping paper is completely
cut in half.
Isn't that great? Yeah, what a good holiday tip.
You've been watching Holiday Magic with Scott and Dan. Join us next time when the boys show you how to make their world-famous Siegfried and Roy nutty German fruitcakes with that fresh Sarmati goodness. See you next time.
All right. What good tips. This is good. All right. Now, I wanted to show you some stuff that I perform regularly. I perform at the Pennsylvania Renaissance Festival every year. This will be my sixth year coming up next season. And I like to, since I was doing the Renaissance Festival, I thought I would dive into the classics of magic. So I would use the Ghiberti, which is referred to as the fun bag. It's actually what it means, the fun bag, and show you a little bit of a cups and balls routine that I do. So we'll attach the old fun bag here and then get into it. So, there we go. Now I'd like to actually begin with a card trick, because what would a magic show be without a card trick?
A good show!
A good show! Exactly. So this is the incredible card trick. What is your name?
Dale,
that is correct. Dale, I'd like you to name any card in the deck. Any card at all in the deck right now, name it out loud.
Jim.
That is correct. All right, good. It could have been anyone. It's a joker. It's wild. So there you go. There you go. Now watch the incredible floating card, the mystery of the incredible floating card. It floats just like that, right in midair. Looks pretty good from your angle. How's it look from over there? Pretty good? Not good enough? All right. So I thought I'd start off with the oldest trick in recorded magical history, well over 5,000 years old, invented by the ancient Egyptians. They called it the cup and ball trick. Now, for those of you, this trick is actually so old it was pictured in the hieroglyphics. So old it was pictured in the lower glyphics. Okay. All over the glyphics. It's nice to work an educated group. For those of you Egyptologists out there, they spelled it snake, snake, sideways guy, beetle. All right, so there you go. So the idea is the ancient Egyptian magician would take the ball, drop it in the cup, he would swirl it around, and the idea was to guess whether the ball was under the cup, in the hand, or in the pouch. Now, if you had to guess, cup, hand, or pouch, where would you say it is?
Cup.
Hand.
Okay, so we're just covering all the bases here. It's not in the hand. It's not under the cup. It actually is in the pouch. But if I want the ball to go in the cup, that's where I use the magic wand. I wave the wand, blow on the ball, snap the fingers, and the ball disappears, travels through the air, and lands underneath the cup. I'll do that again, giving you a chance to clap next time that happens. Now, often magicians would say some kind of magic words. They would make it disappear. They would say something like, spiritae mihi infernali obedite, or some nonsense, and the ball would disappear. Unless you're watching too close, then nothing happens. So we say the magic words in honor of the late, great Ricky Jay. Spiritae mihi infernali obedite. And that ball simply disappears, flies through the air, and lands underneath the cup. Ta-da! Nice. Now, I was doing that for a lady last week, and she said to me, Scott, I know how you do that. You must have two balls. And I do. I keep them both in the cup, right there. Now, chances are, if I have two balls, I probably have two cups, which I do. So I want you to watch this very carefully. Two cups, two balls. We cover this ball, we cover this ball. A magical tap, and the balls change places. It's subtle, but if you're dyslexic, you may have noticed some movement. I used to be dyslexic, but I'm KO now. All right, so we'll put that there. Three balls and three cups. Now it begins to look much more like the paintings on the tombs at Beni Hassan in Egypt. Each one of these balls will vanish one at a time, and you will not know where it goes. Ball number one vanishes like a mirage on the shifting sands of the Sahara. Ball number two will vanish, much like Kevin Spacey's career. Ball number three will also disappear. Sorry, I didn't get that one down in time. Sorry. Now, we do have to wait a little while for the balls to come back. But when they come back, they always return to the little homes underneath the cup. Yeah. Now, I do like to think of these as little homes for the cups. Every cup gets a ball. This cup gets a ball. This cup gets a ball. And this cup gets a ball. And you get a choice.
Oh, boy.
I'd like you to choose cup number one, cup number two, or cup number three. You can have a free choice. Any cup that you like. Cup number one, cup number two. Or cup number three.
Which number three?
Number three, amazing! Amazing, I had no idea. No, but seriously, you could choose any one. It could be one, it could be two, or it could be three. Don't let me influence you. Which one would you like?
Let's go with one.
One, fair enough. Then I shall remove a ball and place it underneath cup number one, which will make how many under there?
Should be two.
Good answer, watch. We remove a ball. It's invisible right there. Yeah. We take it, we put it right under there. And now, because you asked, that ball is now residing comfortably underneath cup number one. Uh-huh. How does that work, you ask?
How does
that work? Oh, I'm glad you asked. The cups all have trap doors in the bottom of it. I can pass the ball right through the bottom of the cup. Mm. I know a lot of you don't believe the trap doors, but check it out. The cups actually go right through each other. See, watch. See? All right, so I put it behind the cup. But anyway, you get the idea. Looks like a trap door. Now then, I want you to be completely honest and completely fair, and I want to make sure there's no funny business going on. So I'll balance a ball, balance a cup on that ball. I'll balance a cup on that ball. I'll balance a cup on that ball. So we need to make sure there's a ball under each cup. Is there definitely a ball underneath that cup? Yes?
Yes.
Is there definitely a ball under that cup?
Yes.
And is there definitely a ball under that cup?
Yes.
Hallelujah. Now, let me explain how this little swindle works. You see, you have two eyes. I have three balls. You can't follow three balls with two eyes. So I will make it easier for you and eliminate the two outside balls. We'll get rid of this one. That one goes into the pouch. And we'll get rid of this one. And that one goes into the pouch. Now that leaves how many balls under the center cup?
Three.
Three? What the hell are you smoking? Just one. All right. Don't get ahead of me. All right. Now, here's the thing. If I want to make this ball come back, I simply grab some magic out of the pouch, tap the cup, and the ball returns. Ooh. Wow. Now, do you know why that works? I never put the ball in the pouch. I only pretend to take the ball and put it in the pouch. It really stays right there. When I want it to go under the cup, I use my little finger and I deposit it behind the cup, simulating the fact that it reappears underneath. Does that make sense? Yeah, see? This show is not only entertaining, it's also educational. But if I really put the ball in the pouch, now how many balls are under the center cup, do we recall? No, now you say three. Three is the time that you say, okay, never mind. But if I really take all three balls and I really do place them in the pouch, do you think I can make them jump back under the center cup? I can't do it. Can't do it. Because there's a big damn orange in the way. Yeah. And if you like that one, you might like that one, or what the hell. There's another one for you. And that is the cups and balls. Nice. I actually have five balls, but anyway, there you go. Mom says I'm special. All right, so there you go. So I did my Chop Cup routine many Penguin Live lectures ago, and I wanted to do the Renaissance Festival. They asked me to do it, and I said, well, I started doing one cup and one ball, but I'm like, you know what? When you look at all these pictures and you go back and you see what it really was like back then, they did the three cups and three balls, so I kind of wanted to revisit that. And come to find out, this kind of routine plays anywhere. It doesn't have to be on the street. It doesn't have to be at a Renaissance Festival. I just did this last month at a corporate event. I did the cups and balls, and I did the linking rings, which I'm going to show you later. And it played in that venue, in a ballroom, in a hotel in Hershey, Pennsylvania, for a bunch of people, Pennsylvania bankers, as it did out in the Renaissance Festival in the middle of a cornfield in Pennsylvania. It's just that good of a trick. So this is not, I mean, this basically the heart of most good cups and balls routine are all based on Vernon, right? The Vernon cups and balls routine. I also borrowed from Gazzo, I borrowed from David Williamson, I borrowed from Bob Sheets, and kind of combined it all. And I made a progressive cup routine that started with my Chop Cup and then expanded out to the rest. So I just want to cover this briefly. And if you have never used a Ghiberti before or a pouch, it's so freeing because I used to keep the lemons in my pockets and all that, but you know what? It doesn't make a difference whether you're loading them out of your back pocket or you're loading them from your crotch. It doesn't matter. They're still going from somewhere here to somewhere here. I don't care if they're coming out of a bag or your back pocket. The audience doesn't care because they don't even know it's coming. So use this. It's been used for centuries. Why not go for it? So I'll just break down this routine quickly. I'm not going to go through a lot of it, but I'll just give you a sense of what I did. These are big steel cups. The bigger the better, I thought. I just took this one and I made a Chop Cup out of it. And I also sprayed the interior of all the cups black because I think the orange or the object coming out of a black void seems better than coming out of a cup. It just seems like it pops it more and it seems, I don't know, it just seems like it's coming out of some mysterious place. So I just put a little magnet in the bottom and I put a piece of black felt over it. And that actually holds the chop that becomes a Chop Cup. So I take two balls, drop them in the bottom cup, then two balls, and then the Chop Cup with the ball in it. That goes in one side of the Ghiberti, and then, you know, a bunch of oranges go in the other side. The wand goes in there, the card goes in there, and you're good to go. Now I'm all set, nothing. So you come out and you do that first gag. I believe Gazzo used to do this a lot. I saw Jay Marshall do it back in the day. I just put some blue tack or orange sticky tack on the beginning of that, and it just makes it really cool, and it just looks pretty good from that side, doesn't it? So that's a nice little gag you can do to open with. And I like to make a lot of noise with the wand, especially if I'm outside. So what I do is I take the first cup and ball out. This is a Chop Cup. And I basically swirl it around, do this Don Allen thing, pretend to take it, leave it, fake transfer. It's gone. It's not under the cup. Set it down, and it's back. Now, when I do that, I also, you know, I steal a second ball and I place, you know, I'd say I'm going to take the third ball and sometimes I'll do a wand spin. And the wand spin, basically, you know, spin it and it makes it look like the ball disappears. The Vernon Wandsman, Mike Kaminskis just put out a nice thing. You can get it on penguin.com about the wand spin. But really the wand spin is just kind of a feel thing. You've just got to get the feel for it. Instead of having it in the back of my hand sticking out like that, I just found I couldn't control it. I just keep it at the very bottom of my hand and I just move my pinky a little bit. So as it spins, you're gonna just turn your wrist, let it dangle between those two fingers. Now, as this comes across, it's all right there. It just kind of comes under that, just falls in your hand and comes away. And it looks really just, you know, magical. They're not expecting it, and it's gone. So I use that. I show it comes back, and then I simply reload that ball from my hand back under the cup, and I do the two-ball joke, and then the two balls appear, right? Now, I set that over here, and I get rid of my magnet ball. I can tell it's my magnet ball because I put two little dots on it, so I know it's the magnet ball. Because I don't want my magnet in the middle of my regular cups and balls routine sticking to the chop cup. So what I do is, now inside here is a ball inside the cup. So I just drop this into the Gioberti and pull out the second one while I roll that ball out into my hand. And now I've got my chop ball is out of play. I do the David Williamson gag, which is wonderful. They change places. Great, great bit. That's my favorite part from his two-cup routine, which is worth studying, I should mention. And then, of course, now I reach in. I dump one ball into my hand and retain it, display the other one, set it on top of the cup, and now we're ready for the beginning of the Vernon sequence. And the Vernon sequence is great. This ball is here, and because you're loading and dumping at the same time. So the excuse of tipping this forward is to let that roll under the cup, right? Pretend to vanish it, do whatever gags. This is just such a beautiful maneuver. It's so good. It's all straight out of Vernon, who took this basically from Mellini. The balls vanish. I do the pretend to eat them gag, and they all reappear under the cup. I like putting the sticky tack on here. It serves another purpose because if you try to do it with just a stick, it'll slip. But the sticky tack allows you to just really cleanly do that and make the cups turn over, which is why I like doing that. Now, the second part of the Vernon sequence, of course, you already have a ball in this hand. You chuck them both under that cup. You chuck nothing under that cup. And you chuck both under that cup. Now, whichever one they say, you're going to remove it from here and place it to either one. You've got a free choice. If they say cup number two, you say, I'll take it from cup number two. Where do you want it to go? Cup number three, great, and you're home free. If they say cup number one or cup number three, you say, all right, I'll just take a ball and I'll put it under that one. Whichever one it's going to end up under, you show them. And now I never liked doing that again and making it appear under the other cup, so I just went for the trap door, guys. I said I pretend to put it in the hand, pass it through the trap door, and now it ends up there. That just seemed to make more sense to me than going back to the well again to milk that twice. So now I've already got a ball in this hand, and I just ditch it in one of the cups as I do the drop through, which is basically you're dropping the top one and catching it and letting the bottom one go. Dropping the top one and catching it and letting the bottom one go. The ribbing along the sides of most cups allows you to do that. So, which is great. There's really a ball in there, and it's just falling through. So now I turn and I just recup that ball in my hand as I balance all of them on the balls. And this is a wonderful display from Gazzo. That I like to use. And now the audience is completely convinced that there's a ball under each cup. Great. Now I like to make this part clear because at this point in most cups and balls routine, it starts to get a little dicey. Like, was there a ball there? I don't know. So I always say, I'm going to remove a ball from this cup. Let him get the point. I'm reloading, setting it down. I'll put it in the pouch. It's a fake transfer, right? I'm going to take this other outside ball, and I always say outside. You know, so just a home, just to hit that in, and I'll put that in the pouch. How many balls under the center cup? Whatever they say, you kind of go for it. We had three. I'll make a joke of that. If they say one, I say it's nice to work in an educated group. I deposit that back in, leave it, set it down. Now I've got two in the middle. I'm ahead. Okay. Now I say I'm going to make that ball return while I steal an orange from the Gioberti. I keep my hand in there. I hit the cup. I look. Always look. Bring that back, that goes right up inside as you take this away and set it down, right? Now, we'll get rid of that one. Now we're gonna make a ball appear under that cup. The reason I can do that is because I actually drop the ball behind the cup. Remember, I've already got one there, right? So what I do is I don't really take the ball, I pretend to take it and I leave it in this hand. And this is Vernon's pseudo explanation for, actually Vernon, when he did it, he said, I actually pretend, I make a maneuver like this and I take the ball and I pretend to take it, but I don't really take it. So he did all that. and it's on YouTube, watch him do this, his cups and balls routine on Mark Wilson's show. It's just really charming and great and just has all the beats in it. It's really good. So I say, I pretend to take the ball, put it in the pouch, but it really stays here. I drop it behind the cup. I don't. I simply lift the cup and keep that retained, and I load a ball at the same time I'm holding a ball in Ramsey subtlety right here. And then I pick that up, which gives me a perfect excuse to hold my hand in that position and set that loaded cup down. Now I can very plainly, and I love this part, this is mine, I just really plainly drop that in the cup. How many balls under the center cup? They say whatever they say at that point. All I'm going to do, because as we know we have two, I'm just going to leave that one there and lift the cup. When they see all three, I load the other ball, and then I stack the balls on top of the cups just like that. Now to end, I say one, two, three. They actually go in the cup. At the same time, I grab my last orange. Do you think I can make it go back under the middle cup? They say yes. I say I can't. They say no. I say you're right, because there's a big damn orange in the way. And I like the Don Allen of hitting the table, because that makes people blink for a second. So you go, because there's a big damn orange in the way. Much easier for you to load that way. I put it on top. And then, of course, at the end, I reveal one, two, and then I always like to reveal this one as it's coming out to show the size difference, and then I stack them up, and then I end the cups and balls just like that. So there you go. The classics! The classics! Ta-ta-da. All right. Because to be honest, you know, the classics are really, really great. Today, we've got a lot of things going on. And right now, to illustrate this, I'd like to do a segment that we call Honest Magic Trailers. Now, I'm not saying that magic trailers try to get you to buy tricks and they're intentionally deceptive about it, although some are. Not much has changed over the years. I may be dating myself, but I remember way back when in the day when ordering from magic catalogs was the way we did things, right? And all those descriptions in the magic catalogs and those wonderful line drawings said that everything was completely amazing, impossible, no skill, and they were impossible. And sadly, most of them were. But after all, we are in the business of selling dreams, right? But imagine what today magic trailers would look like if they were actually honest. What would they look like?
If you love wandering the streets aimlessly and performing magic with garbage, then this trick is for you. This classic illusion of street magic features amazing visuals, awkward hand positions, and ground toppets. And it even sorta kinda sounds like you're opening a sealed can. Sort of. And from watching this trailer, I'm sure you'd get the impression that this can be done anytime, anywhere, impromptu. And that's exactly what we want you to think. This trick is so amazing, it'll make random black dudes want to hug you. The illusion was first created by Anders from Sweden and popularized by David Blaine on his 2002 special, Vertigo. So if you're a millennial and didn't realize that this trick had already been out there, we're going to resell it to you and make you think you can do it anytime and anywhere, and that the can is completely examinable. But it's not. Unless you want them to see the little hidey hole you put in. That's part of the preparation. But it's completely impromptu. But not really. Come on, guys. You know you want to hug him. Go ahead. Oh, dude, I wouldn't do that. That just came out of the trash. Oh, well.
Honesty is the best policy. Now, if practicing magic for you is more of a suggestion than a habit, because you're a lazy American magician, then although this trailer is well produced, this DVD, sadly, will most likely just end up on your shelf.
If you really enjoy watches, clocks, hourglasses, books, and balls, you're gonna love this brand new from the guy with the stickiest balls in the business.
Hello, that's me. Confetti. More balls. Colored balls. Lots of colored balls. Manipulating balls. More hourglasses and hand wringing. Jeff McBride says this stuff. More frickin' confetti. Shrinky candle. Ooh, Lu Chen likes my balls too. There's floating and jiggling balls. Plastic car goes bye-bye. If you're ready to torture yourself with stuff you couldn't possibly do, then you need this DVD. A brand new release from Not Shin Lim.
Ah, yes, yes. Yeah. Now, sometimes magic tricks look amazing in some people's hands, and sometimes in your hands it might make you look a little creepy, right? So just be sure your motives in performing these tricks are honest, just as honest as our last trailer.
Hello, my name is Tom Stone, and this is Off Dice and Mel.
If you're looking for a trick that allows you to give unexpected hugs to strangers, then this one's for you. A trick that's so easy to do, yet no one's doing it. Except for this guy. And this guy. And this guy. And, well, okay, pretty much everybody's doing it. A trick that allows creepy guys to get pelvis to pelvis with unsuspecting victims. Oops, I mean volunteers. Plus, it has the added benefit of making you look like a psychopathic, homicidal serial killer. What could be better? So if you're one of those middle-aged, socially awkward white guys who enjoys hugging women at magic conventions just a little bit too long, then this one will definitely expand your repertoire. Oh yeah.
How was that?
That was definitely...
So now how many people have heard of the term grabbing for the brass ring? You heard the term grabbing for the brass ring? A lot of people have heard of it but don't know actually where it comes from. I happen to have a brass ring here and a piece of cord. We're going to thread that brass ring onto the cord. Now, the origin of this phrase is actually from up in the carousels back in the old days. The brass ring used to hang from a cord. And if you actually were able to grab the brass ring, you would win a prize. So right now, the only way to grab this brass ring is to remove it from either this end or this end of the cord. Get a nice little close-up of that. You see, it really is on there. Now watch very carefully because I'm going to try to use a little bit of magic to be able to grab the brass ring. One, two. Just like that, right off the cord. Now, if you would you like to examine that? Yep. It's absolutely out of the question. No, I'm just kidding. Take a look at that. Make sure that is solid all the way around. And if you would examine the cord, pull on it, tug on it, make sure it's absolutely solid. You find the ring to be solid?
Yes, sir.
Excellent. The cord to be solid.
Yes.
Then let's try another miracle. Simply a ring and a cord. Once again, the brass ring gets threaded through the cord. Now, instead of trying to grab for the brass ring, which is very difficult, the only way to get the brass ring, as I mentioned before, would be to remove it from one of the two ends. This time, instead of trying to take the brass ring off the cord, we're going to try to put it on. Watch. One, two, three. Would you tug on that? Make sure it's absolutely solid, really on there?
Yes.
Good, good. Thanks. Vigorous tugging. Enjoy it. Now, this time we'll do it a little bit differently. Once again, just the ring and just the cord. The ring goes on the cord, and I'm going to leave it here in the palm of my hand. Would you help me for a moment? Come on up. I'm going to close my hand around that brass ring, capturing it forever. We'll actually cross the two across the back of my hand. If you would take your finger, place it right there in the center. Now, we're going to try to remove that brass ring from the cord. What I want you to do is take the end of one of those cords now with that same hand. Take the end of the cord, the end, and pull it straight through my fist. And the brass ring is off and gone. That works sometimes. Now, one last time, if you wouldn't mind for a moment. This time, we're going to try it on your thumb. So hold up a thumb. Excellent. We're going to place the ring, the cord, through the ring once again. And I'm going to leave this here on your thumb, just like that. All right? Now, of course, I can't let you see exactly how I'm going to do this. So we'll cover it with the mystical hanky of India. Made in Taiwan. Okay. Right over there. Now, the only way, of course, for me to get that brass ring off of there would be to remove it. Can you feel that?
Mm-hmm.
All right. And I'm going to actually slide it off of one end. That would be the only way to do it.
Yes.
Yet, if you reach for the brass ring, which means getting something successful and holding on to something that you can really rely on and become successful with throughout your life, the real secret is, just like in The Wizard of Oz, that you have that power the whole time. And never let it go. Thank you so much. Thank you. Now, this is a wonderful little routine, and it uses a prop that that is not often explored or used a lot, the Jardine Ellis ring. It's a wonderful trick, and it's comprised of a solid brass ring and a shell of a ring that goes over top of it. And when you put these two things together, it's one solid ring. There's a multiplicity of things you can do with this. There's a lot of literature on it. You have to kind of dig for it, but you can find it. But I really was fascinated with this prop, and I wanted to create a routine that I could do walk around, that I could do one phase of and stop. Or I could do two phases up and stop. Or I could do three or four phases. It could be anything from, and then it could also expand to include a greater group of people. So I like to use this a lot during walk around because you can segment it into different parts. So I'll just talk through the basic routine for you. And really, you should explore this because I'm sure there's lots of ideas that you can come up with too. But it begins with, I keep the shell in my pocket and I just start with the brass ring and the cord. This is a move that I came up with, I don't know, sometime in the late 80s, early 90s. I haven't seen it in print. I've looked for it, but it's a really interesting ring and string move, and it's really counterintuitive. What I do is I thread the ring through the string, but I leave the front end about half the distance of the back side. So as you can see, that's going through there. The front's a bit shorter. Okay. Now, what I do is I insert my third finger in here as I place it into my hand, and I'm placing it, pushing it down in between my first and second fingers and trapping it there. Now, as I trap it there, this finger just continues on like that. And because it's going against the pattern of the other black cord, it looks like you didn't do anything, right? It looks like it's still threaded through there, so you and I can pull, but it's really off the ring already. I'll do that again. It's really optically deceptive. So if you do this, you place the ring here, and you just continue on, and it's already off. That third finger does it. Now you pull. Now this is another interesting thing I came up with. If you take your thumb now, and you push it up through the ring on the right-hand side, you push it up through, it creates this picture that is still on the cord. But it's not on the cord. It's actually off of the cord. It's going around underneath the ring, tucked up a little bit in there, and coming back out. So now all you have to do, even though that really looks like it's wrapped around, see that? Really looks like it's around the ring, it just comes right off. I'll do that one more time just so you can see it. Place it here, that goes there, draw it right back, show it, thumb goes up through. It really does look like it's on there, yet comes right off. So that's part number one. Yes, hours of practice and self-denial, as Jay Marshall would say. Now, as I hand the rings out for examination, everyone gets to check the rings. While they're doing that, I just take the shell out of my pocket, and I nest it in my hand, complete. Now then, I put the ring through the string. There it is. And now, I keep the shell side facing the audience. I lay it in the palm of my hand. And now, when I pick this up and remove it, I'm just taking the shell off, but I'm leaving that inside my hand. Right? I set it down. I'll often do this or keep it here, and I just drag some of this down so it hangs. Now, all I do is when I bring this up, I keep this clipped between my first finger and pinky, and then when I hit it, I just release this ring, and it drops down. But when you combine the action of this, it looks like that goes right on there, which is a wonderful move. And now I can show it and have someone tug on it. Then I flip the Ellis ring back into my hand, let this slide down and nest once again back into the Ellis ring, and I'm completely clean. Show both. The third part of the move is the old, I forget what you call that, wraparound thing. I don't know what that is, but when I do, I set it
here. You're asking me now?
Yeah, I'm asking you now. I don't know what it is.
Don't ask me now.
All right. So the shell is down. The shell is down. So when I turn it over, the shell remains up. But it really goes through the crisscross.
Crisscross. Yeah. Yeah, so, but I was trying to think of the guy that came up with it, but yeah, I can't do that now.
Yeah, crisscross will make you jump. You know, that's how it is. All right. So, okay. So I close my hands around it, do it, and now I simply scoop this up, toss it over the back of the hand. As the hand passes underneath, the ring drops, the ring and the shell, and just continues around like that. And then I finger palm it as I ask the person to put their finger there. And now simply it's just a simple matter to put your thumb in there with the shell and the ring and open your hand. And you're shielded from view on most of the angles. There's really no bad angle here. They pull that through your hand, and it's really startling walk around when they see that's gone. And then you can reveal it on your thumb. You say, that only works, you know, thumb times, or isn't that thumb thing, or, you know, however that works, and it goes back on your thumb. And now you're setting this, the reason I'm using the thumb is to set up the real great part of the Ellis ring is the last phase. When you put that on the person's thumb and it comes back, because you can't, because it's been warmed up with body heat, when I remove the shell, I can't feel that that's still there. Right? When the shell comes off, you cannot feel, you didn't feel it, did you? You can't feel that it's there, which is really cool. You get one of those kind of SpongeBob moments right in the person's hand. But then all I added to it was keeping the string through it to keep the routine consistent. So I just put that on the person's thumb. I cover it with a handkerchief. And then all you do is you remove the shell and scrape it along the side of their thumb so they feel it. They get the feeling of that being removed and they see it. And then that's already left. Your ending is set up already, but they cannot feel it, so you're way ahead of the audience. So then I just do a fake transfer, just a fake transfer, and the same hand that has the shell whips the cloth away, and it returns onto their thumb, and they're left with quite a startling moment. So that's my little take on the Ellis ring.
Well, it's time for Magic Update!
Yay!
This is Magic Update. All the magic news you need to know with your hosts, Dan Harlan and Scott Alexander.
Hello, I'm Scott Alexander.
And I'm Dan Harlan, and this is Magic Update. Many customers often lose the DVDs that come with Scott Alexander's products. Now, Scott gets many calls to replace those pesky lost DVDs, so he's hired a product replacement specialist. Her name is Helen Hunt. So the next time that you have to hit Scott up to replace a lost DVD, you can go to Helen Hunt for it.
Good. The ridiculously good-looking Tyler and Misty Knight will be headlining at the Casablanca Resort in Mesquite, Nevada. For those of you not familiar with Mesquite, Nevada, it's basically Vegas for people without teeth. They will open next weekend for what's shaping up to be two sold-out shows. In a bold publicity move, they have slightly altered their promotional photographs to blend in more accurately with the local townsfolk of Mesquite, Nevada.
Yeah, it ought to work. Yeah, there you go. Looking good.
Hope that strategy pays off.
I think it will. I think it will.
Yeah.
Luc Germain has announced that he's quitting mentalism. But as it turns out, it's a bigger struggle than he had hoped. Now, luckily, he's decided to join Mentalists Anonymous. Hopefully, he will find healing and rehabilitation in their 13-step program.
David Copperfield is debuting a new gender-bending illusion called transmogrification. In this bold new effect, he defies science itself, using only the power of his mind to magically transform himself from a man to a woman.
Ooh, oh, pretty. Yeah.
Bernardo Sedlak purchased a Houdini action figure from eBay last month and put it in his magic drawer for safekeeping. He recently went to display his figure on his magic shelf, and much to his surprise, Houdini had sadly escaped.
Oh, yeah. Well, look at that.
Yeah.
Who'd have thunk it?
Who'd have thunk it? Actually, you know what, Dan? I used to be an escape artist.
Really?
Yeah, but I got out of it.
Just going to wait for them to groan away until I do this.
Good stuff.
Custom card decks are all the rage, and the newest series to hit the market is entitled Planets. The latest deck in this 8-deck set is the Uranus deck. Now, when you ask a layman to sign a card, you can pull it out of your Uranus. A conventional Pluto deck will not be part of the series because including Pluto as a real planet is just fucking goofy. Which, incidentally, is the reason that Mickey Mouse divorced Minnie Mouse.
Why is that?
She was also fucking goofy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
A little delayed laughter on that one.
It's all right.
British magician and comedian Martin Cox will be launching a new...
No joke there.
No joke there. Yeah. British magician Martin Cox will be launching a new show at the Edinburgh Fringe Festival next year. He recently had a contest on Facebook to find a new name for his one-man show of powerful close-up magic. After receiving many entries, he finally settled on one from Harold Pfister of San Francisco, California. The new title of Martin Cox's close-up one-man show will be entitled Cox in Your Face.
There you go. And, you know, I think we should give a big throbbing thanks to Harry Pfister for that.
Yes, yeah. Thank you, Harry.
Yeah. And now it's time to turn to our Words of Good Cheer segment, where we wish magicians well who are feeling a little under the weather.
Fair enough.
The oldest living magician, Bob Scratchworth of Tucson, Arizona, recently turned 104. We just received a wonderful message of well wishes for him today. It reads, "Happy birthday, Bob, on your special day. Love, Mom and Dad."
Well, that's nice.
A new motion picture starring Hugh Jackman is set to highlight the life and times of masked magician and Las Vegas local celebrity Jeff McBride. The new biopic is set to be titled The Greatest Shaman. There it is.
Looking forward to that. Yep. Michael Lamar performed at the Magic Castle this week and as a final load produced two potatoes. Upon the revelation of the potatoes, he overheard an elderly lady in the front row say, "Those potatoes remind me of my husband's balls."
There's more to this story.
A little stunned, Amar questioned, "Your husband's balls are that big?" To which she replied, "No, they're that dirty."
Oh, well, there you go. All right, let's see. Here's one. Here's a thinker for you. Okay, all right. So Teller, of Penn and Teller fame, has decided to produce dry cigarettes from a bowl of water.
Dry cigarettes from a bowl of water.
It's kind of like the sands of Egypt, but with cigarettes.
Dry cigarettes. Yeah,
yeah. So to keep them dry, he wanted to wrap them in a prophylactic. You know what that is.
A condom.
Yes. So while purchasing them, he was asked by a pharmacist at the local Walgreens how many condoms he would need. Needless to say, the pharmacist was surprised to hear Teller say, "Well, let's start with 200. for the week,
you know,
that's all I need." And then
shocking.
Yeah, shocking. A little shocking. Yeah. And then the pharmacist inquired, "Well, what size do you want?" And Teller thought for a moment, and he said, "You got anything that will fit a camel?"
Is
Okay, anyway. All right. So now, after being closed for 10 years, Houston's Magic Island will reopen next month. The place remained vacant for over a decade, and it's fallen into disrepair, becoming a wretched hive for vagrants, losers, ne'er-do-wells, and squatters who left the place a disgusting mess. Scott Wells is the new entertainment director, and he told Magic Update that they are on track for opening in the next few weeks, and they can't wait to welcome the new batch of vagrants, ne'er-do-wells, losers, and squatters who will soon be performing there. That's the news, and I'm out of here.
This has been Magic Update on the Magic Channel. Stay tuned for our favorite game show coming up next, where contestants compete to identify whether these photos are magicians, pirates, or gay erotica. That's right, folks. Next, it's magician, pirate, or porno. Coming up next on the Magic Network.
Ah, can't wait to tune in for that one. Wow, that's going to be fun. So I like to make little doodles or drawings, and I made a little pad with some doodles on it. I'll put that there in case we need it for later. But for right now, I'd like to ask someone, let's get someone in the second row there. What is your name?
Phil.
Phil, what I want you to do is I want you to think of your favorite four-letter word. Okay. Not that one. Concentrate. Think of your favorite four-letter word. Are you thinking of it? Got it in mind? All right, concentrate. We're going to give this a shot. All right. I'm going to see if I was able to pick up on your thoughts. Do you have any idea what I wrote down on the pad? No? No. Look at that. Wow. Look at that. See, I'm right. K-N-O-W. That wasn't the four-letter word you were thinking of, was it? All right, what was the four-letter word you were thinking of?
Phil.
Like P-H-I-L? Why? What's significant about that? Oh, it's your name. Oh, Phil. Okay, well, I should have guessed that. Phil, I'm going to draw something. I said I like to make doodles, right, Phil? So I'm going to make a little doodle. I want you to see if this means anything to you, all right? See if this little doodle means anything to you. I'm going to show it to the audience, and then I'm going to show it to you, and I want you to tell me if it means anything to you. All right, take that. Tell me, does that little doodle mean anything to you?
Yes.
It does. What does it mean?
Little top hat.
Little top hat?
Magician.
He's a magician. Exactly right. Now, I don't know if you know this, but earlier I kind of showed this to the audience. It has a little drawing of a little magician right there, right? Now, it's wrapped together with a rubber band, and it actually becomes sort of a cartoon. I'll show you what I mean. You can see he's drawn. He's drawn a little different there. He's drawn a little different there. Much like those old flip books from the 19th century. When you flip through, you can actually see a picture animate. So I want you to watch this. Get this really close. As I go ahead and flip through, you'll notice he's going to reach up there and take off his hat. He's going to toss it way up in the air. He's going to reach into his hat and he's going to remove, that's not a magic wand, that's a crayon. He's going to take that crayon and get rid of the hat and walk over to the board. He's going to go ahead and write something on the board. Ooh, he's looking at you, Phil. Ooh, and he just winked at you. Look at that. He's. Now, as he goes through, he's going to write something on that piece of cardboard. He's going to turn it around. Now, when he turns that card around, I want you to be amazed that there's no way I could have known you were going to think of the word Phil. Yet that's exactly what he drew on the card. And that's for you. You can take that home and give it there. Let's hear it for Phil. Yes. Now, of course, you will recognize that from Dan Harlan's wonderful trick cartoon. I just put out a brand new version, and it took a long time to get out because there was a lot of difficulty with printing and all that kind of stuff, but it is now available on penguinmagic.com. And I figured I'd do it justice and show you a little performance of it so that now you can go on penguinmag.com. And for only, I don't know, a couple bucks, you can get one of these.
Yeah, it's worth it no matter what. I got to be honest. You know, people have worked with Cartoon for over 25 years. It's about 26 or 27 years old. But nobody has done anything original or different with it. And this takes it to the next level to do absolutely any word. You know, and Scott's presentation as far as limiting it to the proper word is the way to go. He won't explain the whole thing. It's actually very, very easy. Very easy to do. I highly recommend. Everybody gets that. It's a really good adjunct to doing cartoon and works in bigger venues. And the best part of it is that you give somebody a souvenir, you know, at the end of it with whatever word they say. Now, let's move on. You know, magic often seems outdated and old. Now, perhaps it's because we cling to history. Perhaps it's because most often it's a craft and not really an art unless we raise it up to that level. So as we move forward, I think we should always embrace the better things from the past, but perhaps reevaluate the things that need to go away. And now, to echo those sentiments for the magic community, here is country music superstar Tim McGraw with his magical Grammy-winning hit, Back When.
Don't you remember the classiness and splendor of folks like Channing Pollock and good old Marvin Roy? Today we got magicians in torn t-shirts and hoodies and jeans that squeeze their goodies. With tattoos and beards galore, they all dress way understated. It's all so overrated. I like the old and outdated way we were. Back when magicians would often smile and dressed with class and style, and didn't look like a banger, or they just rolled out of bed. Back when we all wore a tux instead of wrinkled jeans and chucks, and when we went to do a gig, we didn't look like sloppy fucks. I miss back when. I miss back when. I miss back when. You know what I'm talking about, Dan?
I do.
Yeah. You know what? Back in the 90s, the bra trick was a classic, and everybody loved it for its cute misogyny. I'd whip out my old sponge ding dong and say, hey, that was the clean one. But now folks think I'm a mean one. It's all just so PC. Today the baby gag is tasteless, and if you do it, you're probably racist. I guess we all have to face this and re-examine what we do. Montage! So give some thought to what you do and try some stuff that's new. You just might find you like it and your audience will too. There's problems we all can solve and we just have to evolve. The future can be brighter for men and women too, so miss back when, but move ahead, or magic's dead.
All right, it's been a while since we've done a card trick, so I know you all have been waiting for this very moment to happen. I have here a deck of cards, and I am going to need someone, in fact, a few of you, to select a card, because I don't want to seem like I have arranged this with anybody at all in the audience, so we need a random selection made. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to ask you to select anybody in the audience. Now, we haven't arranged anything, have we?
No.
That's exactly what somebody would say if we had arranged something. That's the problem. So I'm going to ask you to select somebody else, and we'll start with them. And then there will be a few other people involved. So who should we use for this? See, and you know, and this is exactly what somebody that I hadn't arranged something would do. The person next to them. Hello, person next to her. What's your name?
Dan.
That's a, you know, it's a, how do you spell, Dan? It doesn't matter. Okay, Dan. Here's what I want you to do. Okay, all you need to do is select either the black cards or the red cards, and it's not one of those weird things where I'm going to say we put this, that, or there. Whatever you choose, black or red, is exactly what we're going to use. So which ones do you want?
Red.
The red ones, okay? Now, just select somebody else. They can be anywhere at all. Yeah, anybody at all. Doesn't matter who it is. Yep.
Backstage right.
Backstage right, and who is it?
I have no idea.
Just where? Way back. Way like back. Way back in the corner? The furthest person back in the corner? Nicholas Lawrence, everybody! It's Nicholas Lawrence! Hey, Nicholas! How you doing, man? That is Dinky from last year, by the way. And unfortunately, the character of Dinky was killed off in a model railroading accident. And so he's not back this year, but Nicholas Lawrence is here. Anyway, so hey, Nicholas, he's chosen the red cards. So that gives you the option of either the hearts or the diamonds. And you know how this works. Whatever you name, that's what I have to use. So which one?
We're going to go with hearts
this time. Okay, so hearts is it. And then you pick somebody else, just whoever you want. Right? Where are
they?
Two over from the camera. In the back? In this row? In the middle row? Is it here? Is this two over or here?
Right, yeah.
Blonde hair. Oh, two over from this camera. Oh, so Braden, is it? Yes? So Braden, we have hearts chosen as the suit. You obviously get to choose the value. I could take it further and have you choose odd and even, but let's just wrap this fucker up. You choose the value of the heart that we're going to use. What value would you like?
Six.
The six of hearts. The six of hearts. Hold on a second. My job is to find the six of hearts. There it is, right there. The six of hearts. Okay, let's try it again. We're going to start with anybody, anywhere, and we're going to have them pick either the... No? We're not going to do it that way? All right, look. Here's the thing. That trick didn't really have, like, the wow factor, you know, what I anticipated it to have. It didn't have the impact, you know what I'm saying? The ending wasn't as strong as we want it to be. There wasn't a payoff. What we might call the ta-da moment. So I'm going to take the six of hearts, and I'm going to place it back into the deck. But I want you to watch it closely as it goes back into the deck of cards, because it goes in facing the same direction as all the other cards. You see? Watch it closely. Now, this is the card you chose. It goes in facing the same direction. But even if I turn those cards face down, that six of hearts resists turning over. In fact, it remains face up. It's the only card that remains face up in the deck. You can see it right there. Can you see it? The six of hearts. Okay, I understand. You probably think I did like Marlowe's Future Reverse or something there. You know, I'm able to do those sneaky things, but it's still missing that ta-da factor. What if, when the six of hearts turned face up, the back of it also changed color? And it says ta-da. Okay, the reason I'm doing this trick is because for the first time in over 2 years, about 2.5 years, I'm revealing exactly the method that I use to fool Penn and Teller. This is the same tabletop. Now, it's not the same base. It had other legs on it, but this is the tabletop that I built specifically to fool Penn and Teller. This is another trick that can be done with this tabletop. In fact, any trick that involves a full 52-card index can be done with this, and you could build one for yourself to do it. So let me kind of explain this trick really quickly, and then I'll explain what I did for Penn and Teller. So this is just a regular deck of 52 cards. There's nothing special about that. What's really going on is behind the scenes here, this is a full 52-card index that's built into the table, and those cards are obviously all arranged in order. This foam cushion that you can see right here is the thing that keeps them from moving. So what you do is you build a felt surface, because the felt also helps, it keeps them from moving, but also helps them to slide a little bit. So you build that felt surface, and then 3.5 inches back from that, you put in some upholstery foam, and then you slip the cards in. Now, they're only held by the pressure of that foam. The top row of cards is holding the bottom row of cards in place, and they are absolutely in order, from the king through the ace here and the ace through the king there, all stacked up, all 52. Now, these are face-up. These are face-up cards, and on the back of every single one of those cards, it's a red-backed card, it says ta-da, and it has an exclamation point. So every single one of these is ready for a final revelation. It doesn't matter what anybody names, they're all there. When I did the Penn and Teller Fool Us, they had to be face-down. So those face-down cards, and I have them here, I don't have the full deck of animation because I gave that away. But here are the remaining 51 cards that weren't named, every one of them. The only card that was named was the 10 of Hearts. So these are the other ones. So every one of these is a final revelation for Cardtoon. But these cards had to be face down, right? Because I had to add them to the bottom, to the end of the deck to perform Cardtoon. And they had to be oriented this way. They had to be turned so that the top here was facing out. So even though I have this indicated with the value and then the suits are mentioned here. So there's club spades, and hearts, diamonds, and then every one of the values is there. Even though I had that, I still had to be absolutely certain that the right card was in the right slot at the right time. So each of these has a tiny number on it. So this one reveals the 8 of spades, so there's a tiny 8 there. This one reveals the 2 of hearts, so there's a tiny 2 there. Right at the top, there's a tiny A here for that. That's an ace. So when these are face down and spread out at a half an inch, they look like this. Now they'd be in order, of course, but I can see a tiny index in the space that I need it to be. So my job, when people were naming the color and the value and the suit and all that, is to find the right one at the right time and slide it out onto this part of the shelf, the extension of the shelf here. Now, it's easier in the trick that I just showed you because it's all face up. So there's no chance that you're going to miss it. With them face down, it's a real challenge. So I have 51 leftover cards that have no purpose whatsoever, because I'll never, ever do the trick that way again. But the way that I made those is this template here. So I made one of them, I drew it, then I cut out all the interiors, and I would lay this over another card, and then with a Sharpie, I would draw inside and then finish the details. And then, in addition to this, I drew an entire new deck of Cardtoon all by hand using the same template so that all of those cards had no special other end design on them so that it could be given away. So this template is, honestly, this is the critical and most important part of that whole trick, was to be able to create 104 cards that all matched properly, so that all the endings match to the other 52 that came before. So that thing is the most valuable part of it. Now, in this trick, it's super, super easy. So all you do, is you have this deck of cards, you have somebody name a card, it doesn't matter what they name, and you're going to spread these out and apparently look for that card, so whatever it is. So, hey, somebody give me a tough one that's not a heart. Because I'll tell you this, this was a funny part of appearing on Fool Us. When I did the rehearsal part of it, and I had people name the cards, they named red, hearts, and 10. Then when I did the performance, they named red, hearts, and 10. And on stage, I'm killing myself going, ah, I just should have put the 10 of hearts at the end. It's the only one that got named the whole time that I was filming. It's the only one. And I had, you know, the 51 others for every possible out. Heart, you know, red gets named more often. It just does. If you give people the choice, it just does. So I knew that that was going to happen. But I didn't know that it was going to go exactly the same as it went in rehearsal. And, oh, it was killing me. Somebody name a different card. Nine of clubs. So I'm here. So what I'm doing out here in the open is I'm looking for the nine of clubs. And down here with my other hand, I take the nine of clubs and I slide it right out here onto this little shelf. So it's just sticking out a little bit. So there's the nine of clubs. And that in the performance for Penn & Teller, that's exactly the same. I didn't do anything with the color, the suit, but as soon as the value was named, I was doing the same thing with an invisible, an imaginary deck of cards. So now when I find the nine of clubs and I push that out with this trick, boom, now all I have to do is pick this deck of cards up and turn them face down. And while everybody's laughing about that nine of clubs, I just add the other one to the bottom. That's it. So now I cut these, turn them face up again, and now I'm in a position so that I can take this nine of clubs, which of course is the blue-backed one, and insert it somewhere into the deck. When I turn the deck over, then the other nine of clubs that I added in is revealed here, and then it's just a matter of showing the back of it. And that is how you can use the method that I used to do a different trick that's actually more practical than what I did.
So, speaking of card tricks, I'd like to do another one for you, but this one is even more dramatic. The one I did earlier, very dramatic. This one, even more dramatic. So what I'd like to do is I'd like to have, who hasn't helped me yet? You haven't helped me yet, have you? What is your name?
Damn.
Damn.
That'll work.
All right. What is it? What's your name?
Tam.
Oh, Tam. T-A-M. Tam. Hi. How are you? Tam. I'm going to go through like this. I'm going to spread through the cards. You just say stop as I go through the cards. All right. Are you ready?
Stop.
Right there. Excellent. I want you to remember this card. Don't tell anybody. Don't tell me. I won't look in the monitor to see what it is. All right. You got the card? All right, good. We'll put it right there. We're actually going to give the cards a little bit of a shuffle. And Tam, I'm going to try to find the cards, all right? One more shuffle, but I'm going to try to find them in a more dramatic way because standard card tricks are boring after all. So right now, what I'd like you to do is to cut the pack and hand me... Good. Cut off a few more. And you're happy with that?
Oh, yeah.
Take those cards, because I have a feeling your card is in that particular packet. Now, what I'm going to have you do is I'm going to have you throw the cards in the air. I'm going to use my ninja-like reflexes. As the cards fly up in an arc right here, I'm going to reach in, snatch your card out of thin air, or should I say out of midair. This is high air. This is low air. This is midair, right here. So throw the cards right here. So snatch the card out of midair. It will be the card that you selected. Are you ready?
I am.
Okay. Do you know how to spring cards?
Yeah.
Yeah, can you spring them?
Okay.
Okay, that'd be even better. That'd be even better, a little more dramatic. Mm-hmm. Spring them right here. Are you ready?
Okay.
All right, let me get ready. Here we go. Snatch it right out of midair. You got the premise?
Go ahead.
Okay, here we go. All right. Let me take my glasses off. Here we go. Okay, here we go. Throw the cards up in the air. On the count of three. One. Whoops. It's all right. It's my fault. I picked you. Okay. No, it's all right. We're gonna try it again. because maybe your card wasn't in that half. Maybe it was in this half. So take this half, get ready to spring the cards. I will use my ninja-like reflexes. I will count to three, and I will grab your card out of midair. Are you ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Hop, hop. One card, and one card only. Damn, for the first time, was that your card?
No.
Damn, you're really starting to piss me off. I can see we're going to have to get even more dramatic than this. So, Tam, I'll tell you what. I'm going to go get the big guns. In the meantime, you pick up all those cards. All right? I'll be right back. Give Tam a big round of applause while he picks up the cards.
Picking up the cards.
Let me know when you're done.
Get all the cards. Anybody want any more eggnog?
All right, screw it. All right, screw it. All right, Tam, back the hell up. Get over there. Get over there. All right. All right, Tam. Now, you got to pay attention this time, all right? I mean business. Okay, all right. Are you circumcised? All right, here we go. Okay. Tam, stand right here. Closer. That's good. What I want you to do, on the count of three, I want you to spring the card. Actually, I better get some, too. Here, let me get some of these. Here, hand me some, and you pick up some more. Good. We don't want to screw this up. All right, Dale's got some cards there for you. Take those, too. Hopefully your card's in there. Tam, here's what's going to happen. I want you to focus. A little closer, right here. Good. Focus right here on this spot in space. Can you see that spot in space? Focus on that spot in space. On the count of three, I'm going to have you toss the cards right to this spot, right here in space. All right. I'm not going to do a practice, because then you're going to have to pick up the damn cards again. All right. So, I want you to focus on that spot in space. Shoot the cards in the air, and we're going to pick them up. Are you ready? One, two, three, go. Hop! Kaya! Oh. One card. Upon the center of the sword. Damn. What was your card?
Jack of Clubs.
Exactly. The Jack of Clubs. Thank you very much. So I put together this one because I would do the card sword a lot. And if you know the regular card sword, the elastic will always break on the card sword. So that was kind of my impetus for coming up with this. So what I did was I just created an end run based on the Shawshank Redemption. So let me explain that, how that works. What I did was, let me get some of these cards to use for you, because this is really a great thing, and you feel pretty good doing this for the audience. I've done this on stage in a big theater for 1,000 people, and I did it, and I didn't think it would work. I was like, this is not going to work. It worked. And the reason, it was a real lesson in psychology. So what I did was, I did this. I took a bunch of cards, and I took a little tiny, if you can zoom in, you can see there's a little magnet on the card here. So what I did basically was I super glued a little magnet to a card. This is a 32nd inch thick magnet. You can get them from KJ Magnetics. And I just made a whole pile of them, right? So this is going to be my force card, and it's got a little tiny magnet on it. So what I do is, I basically keep that card on the top of the deck. Now, I force the card on someone using the riffle force, or basically I cut it to the center of the deck, I riffle, and then just cut at that point and show them the card. They're seeing the magnet card. If you so desire, you can take that card out of the deck, keep your thumb over the magnet, and have them put their initials on it while your thumb is covering the magnet. So it could be a signed card too, if you want. So they can sign that. Then you simply shuffle it to the top of the deck, right? And now the magnet card is on the top. Now you go through the rigmarole of, okay, throw the cards up in the air on the count of three to create your first beat, right? Which is very funny. It always works. It's a wonderful moment of comedy. Then the second time, when I give him the other half of the deck after he's cut it, I simply top palm two cards, the gimmicked magnet card and the other card. I keep it in the palm of my hand. He throws those up in the air. I simply clap my hands, hold the two cards as one, and show that once again it's the wrong prediction. Now, I walk off stage and I say, I'm going to get the big guns. You pick up the cards. And when you do this for an audience of laymen, it's really funny. Sometimes I'll play, a song like, every day I'm shuffling, and make them you know, have fun with picking up the cards. And then, so when I go off stage, what I do is I get rid of that card and I take this card with the magnet on it. On the bottom of my shoe, I have a little envelope that I made, right? Right? And I simply tuck the card into this little slot and it sticks out of the bottom of my shoe about that much. Because as you remember in Shawshank Redemption, when he's walking out, he says, "No one ever thinks to look at a man's shoes." So I guarantee when I walked out here, nobody knew that card was sticking out of the side of my foot. Then I assume what is called in ballet, second position, right? With this foot cocked up stage. I'm using the point of the sword to dictate his point of focus and the audience's point of focus. So no one even knows that card is sticking to my foot. I also epoxied a tiny magnet to the end of the sword. You can use any sword for this, and your elastic is never going to break, which is wonderful. So all I do is, while I say, watch right here, now everyone's focusing there, I simply put the point of the sword on the card, it doesn't matter where, and I move my foot away, right? And now if I just move the sword, the card just jumps right to the magnet. And it stays there on the ground. And now keep in mind, you probably have several other cards on the ground that are going to camouflage it. Nobody's going to know. Even if they're looking from the balcony, they can't tell that that card is there, right? So now, basically, everyone's focusing here at this moment. You shoot the cards in the air and just simply bring your card up. Don't hit the cards with the card, or it could knock it off, but try to go past it and let all the cards fly here, and that card will remain impaled on the end of the sword, which is a great moment. Then, also, as part of the preparation, I put a tiny slit in the card so I can shift it and slide it, like in a traditional card sword, down the hilt of the card sword. And then I want to leave them with this impression, right? So that the card is there. Now I ask them to name the card. Now I simply take my thumbnail and kick off that magnet, which actually sticks to the blade, which goes away. Rip off the card. He can take that as a souvenir. It could be signed. And that is sort of my non-elastic card sword. So there you go.
Yeah. All right. A little bit of housekeeping right here. Make myself comfortable. Get rid of some of this stuff. Ladies and gentlemen, we are honored to have with us again this year a sage, a shaman, a mystic. He's a traveler from the east side of Pennsylvania. He's part prophet, part non-prophet, and a spiritual advisor to Kanye West. He's here to demonstrate his skills in clairvoyance and mental agility. Please welcome Karnak the Magnificent.
Thank you. A thousand blessings on you, Dan Harlan.
Thank you, Greg.
And may you always find wisdom in the anagrams tattooed on Peter Turner's face.
As I do. I hold in my hands the envelopes. As any child of four could see, these envelopes are hermetically sealed. They have been kept in a mayonnaise jar on John Stetson's porch since noon today. No one knows the answers to these questions, but you, in your mystical, divine, and borderline way, will ascertain the answers before ever having seen the questions, the first envelope.
I shall divine the answers.
Divine the answers before seeing the questions.
Yes.
That's what you do. That's the bit.
That's the bit. Smart ass deck.
Smart ass deck.
Where do comedy magicians stay on a cruise ship?
Fair enough. Good. Yes. Good one.
Oh, John Stetson.
Oh, John Stetson.
John Stetson. What do you call a cowboy hat that you wear on the toilet? May Shin Lim forever blow mystical smoke up your ass. Al Flosso.
Al Flosso.
What does Al do before brushing his teeth?
Yeah, of course. All right. Sure. It makes sense.
Unbelievable.
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 What do you call an antelope who does magic? Position impossible.
Oh, no. Position impossible.
What does Brent Braun think about number 37 in the Kama Sutra? Close, but no cigar.
Close, but no cigar.
What do you call Mike Close when he left Cuba empty-handed?
Simple. Makes sense. Yeah. Sure, there you go.
Lance Burton.
Lance Burton.
Lance Burton.
Lance Burton. Mm.
What does your dermatologist do to an inflamed Burton?
I swear we've done that one before.
We may have. I don't know. Apocalypse Now.
Apocalypse Now. Mm.
What does Harry Lorraine call his new magazine?
Move on.
May a diseased scorpion crawl up your toppet. The professor's nightmare.
Give me a second. This is a good one.
The professor's nightmare.
The professor's nightmare.
That's what I said. What was Vernon's nickname for Howard Hamburg?
I told you. Okay. Good one.
Thank you. May Noel Quarters Bliss fill your pants. Sneezy, grumpy, doc, dopey, bashful, sleepy, and sneezy.
Wait. I think you're going for
sneezy, grumpy, dopey, doc, bashful, happy, and sleepy.
Yeah, there you go.
That's right. Yes, okay.
Yes.
Who's running the creative team over at Illusionist?
There you go.
Ooh. A little dig of the competition.
Oh, yes.
Leonard Green and Rubik's Cube. Leonard Green and Rubik's Cube. Name two things that are square and hard to understand.
I hold in my hand the last envelope.
Yes. Okay. May Jeff McBride give your grandma a kabuki streamer. A nail, a board, and a sans mind customer.
Mm, a nail, a board, and a sans mind customer.
Name something that's hammered, something that's sawed, and something that's screwed.
Yeah! There you go, the great Karnak!
Thank you so much.
Wonderful! Oh, yes. All right. Okay, well, I gave up the method that I used on Fool Us. Probably some of you already knew it, but that solidified it for you. But, you know, there's one thing that dates back even further. 6 or 7 years ago, I can't remember how long it's been, I did my very first Penguin Live lecture, and I performed an any card at any number. And I told everybody that if they approached me personally, I would teach them how to do it. And I've kept that promise for the past 6 or 7 years, but I haven't taught it publicly at all. But this is my Christmas gift to you. I will now show you exactly how I like to perform any card at any number. I have restrictions for it. I've always loved the plot. I've always loved the idea. But my restrictions are that you should be able to perform any card at any number with any deck at any time anywhere. So any deck of cards, you can do this. But you should make it seem like it's as impossible as you can. All right, so I'm going to show you, and I'm going to give you some of the techniques as I perform it for you and explain exactly what I do. The basic thing is that there are two parts to it. One of them could be considered pre-show. It's considered pre-show because when you perform this, you want to do part of it, and then all of a sudden say, wait a second, maybe we should record this for posterity. So you do the first part, and then you tell everybody to take out their cell phones and record the second part of it. But honestly, if you want to do the whole thing, it's still pretty much bulletproof. And to show you that, I'm going to get two people up who have not been prepped in any way. There's been no actual pre-show. And I'm going to show you the whole performance and then explain in the middle of it where you would start recording it. And you'll see the difference. So, hi, what's your name?
Steve.
Steve, is it?
Yes.
Yeah, Steve, come on over here. stand right over there. And then, hi, what's your name?
Rick.
So Steve and Rick. Steve and Rick are going to be the two people that I perform for you. Come in a little bit closer, guys. Steve, you're familiar with the deck of cards, yes?
Yes.
So what I want you to do is to kind of mix those up. Now, while he's mixing those up, Rick, I want you to think of absolutely any card in the deck, okay? Any card at all. This is not something that I'm going to influence you to think of. It can be your choice, absolutely. So you can change your mind as many times as you want to, but once you settle on a card, don't change your mind. Okay. Keep that card in your mind, picture it as big as you can, and just make sure that you remember that card. Don't ever change your mind from that point. And there's no way that I could know what that card is. There's no way that Steve could know what that card is. All right, now, the only problem is that, Rick, I don't know if that card's in this deck. It may or may not be a full deck. So what I want you to do is I want you to look through, see if your card's in that deck, and if it is, take it out of the deck. Do that while my back is turned. Now, Rick, I'm going to have you think of a number. It's going to be a number from 1 to 52, but I'm not going to influence you in any way. I also don't want you to think of some of the more common numbers that might pop into people's heads, numbers that people associate with luck or with the age that they're able to drink those kinds of things. There are various numbers along the way that are really popular. Now, you might think of one of those. Instead, I'm going to have you do this randomly. Steve, have you taken your card out?
Yes.
Hand me the rest of the deck. Yeah. Okay, good. Now, we know that your card's in the deck, so I want you to look at it, and I want you to remember what it is. I want you to just take a moment to look at it, but I won't look at you, and don't show it to Steve, okay? So, Rick, as I run the cards into my hand like this, just toss your card in absolutely anywhere. Yep, you happy with that?
Yep.
That's fantastic. We're just going to run it down into there so that it's lost somewhere in the deck. In fact, I'll even shuffle them to make sure that I don't know where your card is. Now, like I said, Steve, yes, Steve? Like I said, I'm going to have you think of a random number. The way you're going to do that is by cutting some cards off while I have my head turned. So I'm going to turn my head, I'm going to look at Rick, you cut some cards off, and then what I'd like you to do, Steve, is to just count those cards silently to yourself so that you know how many cards are there. And after you're done counting them, you're going to put them right back on top, okay? So make sure that you get the exact number. This is going to be a random number that even you couldn't have anticipated, and then you just put them right back onto the deck. You got the number in mind? Yeah, don't forget that number, whatever number that happens to be. And in fact, I will even shuffle the cards to make sure that I don't know your number, and I definitely don't know your card. Here, you hold on to those cards.
Okay.
You know what? We should probably film this for posterity, because something weird is going to happen here. So if you guys happen to have a cell phone, you can take out your cell phones now. It's best if you set them on airplane mode or something like that where you can't receive a call because we don't want any interruptions, but it's okay if you film everything that's going on. You got a number in mind?
Yes.
Yep. You got a card in mind?
Yep.
And you've got the deck in your hands. Everybody ready? Everybody ready to film? Yeah. And you can be anywhere. You can come up here if you want to film. You can film him. You can film from behind me. You can stay there. It's entirely up to you. Are we going? Everybody filming? Good. So, hi, oh, we have Steve, yes?
Yes.
Steve and Rick.
Yep.
Now, I've just met you guys. I haven't spoken to you earlier or anything like
sure.
that. So what I've done is I've given you a deck of cards, okay? And what's going to happen here is I'm going to have you think of a card, and you're going to think of a number, and then we're going to see if a coincidence happens, okay? So you're thinking of a card that I couldn't have influenced you. It could have been any card in the deck, yes?
Correct.
Is that right? And you've got one in mind?
Yes.
You got one in mind right now?
Yes.
And you're not changing your mind?
Correct.
And you're going to keep that very same card in your mind this whole time. And you don't know what card he's thinking of, do you? There's no way. You could guess at it, but there's no way. The other thing is, you're thinking of a number, and it's got to be a number from 1 to 52. Do you got a number in mind from 1 to 52?
Correct.
And it's a random number. It's not like psychologically influenced in any way, although it could be. You could be thinking of a very special number. Like, a lot of people think of a lucky number, or they think of an unlucky number, you know, or they think of a number that relates to them in some kind of a way. Does this number relate to you in any way?
Kinda.
So it's not really like a strong association. No. You've got a number from 1 to 52 in mind, and you've got a card in mind, yes?
Yeah.
And you also have a deck of cards in your hand.
Yes.
I want you to come in a little bit closer, okay? I'm going to hold my hand out in front of me like this.
Okay.
Now, I'll count to three. When I say three, I want you to say your card, and I want you to say your number, and I want you to say it at the same time, because you might think he's on it, and you might think he's in on it, and this way, nobody can change what they're saying based on what the other person says. You got it? So you say a number, you say a card. You ready? One, two, three.
18. Six of diamonds.
Okay, so you said 18, and you said six of diamonds.
Correct.
Am I right? 18, six of diamonds. All right, what I'd like you to do, from the top of the deck, face up into my hand, deal the cards face up one at a time and count them. Go ahead.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17.
Stop right there. That's 17 cards have gone by without seeing your eight of diamonds.
Six of diamonds.
Six of diamonds.
Yes.
Okay, six of diamonds. Okay,
yeah.
Six of diamonds, yeah. So the 18th card is the next one. If that's the six of diamonds, you guys have created a miraculous coincidence. Show everybody six of diamonds.
Wow. Incredible.
Okay, you can put your phones away. All right, so here's what's actually going on, and it's great. You know, there's a lot of pre-show reality that's happening that creates a dual reality by the time it's being filmed. So the first thing is he's shuffling, and I know it's a full deck, but it wouldn't even matter if it was. It wasn't. I'd borrow it.
Actually, he dropped one.
Oh, and that's fine. And that's fine, too. The chances of him thinking of that lost card are very minimal, and you can deal with it. If he thinks of a card that's not there, you just have him think of a different card. That's it. But you want to get a card in his mind while the deck is not in his hands. That's critical. He doesn't have cards in his hand. Because the memory that you want to create for this guy is a thought of card. That's it. Okay? Because what you're actually going to do is then take these cards and have him take it out. So it's really a selected card. So we all know that. He thinks of a card, then he takes it out. So go ahead and you can take the six of diamonds just so we know what we're doing. So it's a selected card without it being selected. It's a thought of card. And I take the rest of the cards back. And then I start to explain to him about the numbers that he's going to choose and how I don't want him to just think of one. We're going to do something special with him. And then I control his card to the top. Now, you can use any control you want. In this case, I prefer the Hindu shuffle. So I Hindu shuffle, and he tosses it in, and I grab it, and I Hindu shuffle it up to the top of the deck. So the last card is his card on top of the deck. Now I palm it and turn to him. So I now have his card palmed, but I don't know what it is. Okay? The whole time, the other thing that makes this pure and really interesting to me is I never know what his card is, and I never know what his number is, but I don't have to, okay? So I have the six of diamonds palmed, and now I say to you, you're going, and this hand does actions that keep it in the same place. So I say you're going to cut cards off of the top of the deck. So I'm doing it with a palmed card, then I drop it, and I turn. So here's the six of diamonds. He cuts it off. And then I say, you're going to count those cards, and then you're going to put them right back here. And I put the six of diamonds right onto the top of the deck. So when he counts his cards, go ahead and count those, whatever it happens to be. So he's got five cards, okay? So I say, just drop those onto the top. Now at this point, his card is in exactly the right position, plus one. That's it. So I've positioned a thought of card at a thought of number with one extra card. So now I say, well, I'm just going to shuffle them. I move a card to the bottom, and I do a false shuffle. And that's it. So my false shuffle, in case you're not familiar with it, is this. Okay? It's all about raising the knee. And that's it. Make the noise and raise the knee. So you raise the knee and do that and push them together. That's my false shuffle. And it's a really, really good one for here. Now I hand him the deck. His card is now at his number. So at this point, I say, you know what? We should film this. Now, it's important that you recap this in a way that it sounds like you're just doing it for the first time. Yeah, for the video. So as soon as you have the videos out, that's when you say, oh, Steve, right? Yes. So Steve, we haven't met before this, have we?
No.
And the thing is, we did. We met 5 minutes ago. But before this is a vague statement, this is still happening for him, but not happening in phone video land. We haven't met before this, and we haven't spoken before this, and I didn't set up anything with you. Now, that's true. I didn't set up anything with him, okay? And I say, I'm going to try to create a coincidence. That's now. That's a proper thing. It's always been that way. But I say, I'm going to try to create a coincidence. You're going to think of a card, and you're going to think of a number. You're going to think of any card you want, and you've got a card in mind that I didn't see. This is really important that you make it seem like it's happening when he's got the deck of cards in his hand, that he's now thinking of the card. And he has no cards in his hand, and he's now thinking of the number. And then, the only thing that you have to be concerned about is that this guy knows how to count. That's it. So you, when your back is turned and he's counting those cards, you got to give him plenty of time and space to make sure that he counts properly, because now, with your subtraction of one card, it's going to match his total exactly. And that's how I do any card, at any number, at any time. Thanks, guys. Thank you.
Well, as we're coming towards the end of the show, I thought I would do something that I really, really enjoy doing. I've had a long love and hate relationship with the linking rings. I did a version, three versions actually, on the fourth Penguin special, I believe, that I did. Just to kind of get you thinking about it, I'd like to close this portion of the show with sort of my version of the linking rings that I'm most excited about, I enjoy the most. I learned this about 20 years ago. A guy named Tom Gaddis taught me this routine, and he finally paid me, by the way, for the car.
Mm.
20 years later.
That's right. We had that in Magic.
Yep.
That he owed you, what was it, 200
bucks? 500
bucks. 500 bucks for a car.
But he paid me even before that with teaching me this linking ring routine. This is really based, I'll give you a little bit of history on it, and I'll encourage you to go and explore this because it's a really fun thing. Jack Miller, who was very famous for The Holdout back in the day, came up with a linking rings poem with five rings set to the tempo of Edgar Allan Poe, Edgar Allan Poe's The Raven. Then later on, Roger Claus came up with a version of it for four rings. Claus would do the Raven poem like Jack Miller did. He kind of rewrote it a little bit, and he did it with four rings. And then he would follow it by doing Whit Hayden's four ring routine. So he did the poem, and then he did Whit Hayden's routine. So that was like 25 minutes of material out of the linking rings, and it was great. Further on, Lance Pierce rewrote it for the Symphony of the Rings, which is kind of the version I'm doing now with some adaptations by myself. And that was taught to me by Tom. So this is one of my favorite things to do. I do it at the Renaissance Festival. I did it at several corporate events. I do it on cruise ships. I do this everywhere. And I just wanted to close it because I think it's a really cool thing. And I think as magicians, we often say the linking rings, nobody cares about those. But sometimes in my show, I'll do the linking rings and I'll do the Himber rings. And people, when I do the linking rings, people are like, wow, that's just so cool. That's amazing. So I think it's not the trick itself, but it's what you add to the trick, what you bring to the trick that makes it important. So I want to show you my favorite linking ring routine, just to kind of close things out. This routine is done with six rings. One, two, three, four, five, six separate rings. A trick that is over 2,000 years old, known as the Chinese linking rings. Done with these solid gold rings. That I had chrome plated to keep the gold from wearing away. By the way, these jokes are over 2,000 years old. With my apologies to Edgar Allan Poe for this one. May I have the special poetry lighting, please? Awesome. This mystic feat I now perform with solid steel in rounded form. A quaint and curious mystery from an oriental shore. Each ring separate, disconnected, doing things so unexpected, suddenly intersected, different than before. Just these two rings and nothing more. And when it comes that I perchance to look upon this happenstance, how rings can link when separate before, I wonder then in my confusion, 'twas perhaps just an illusion? Could it then be my delusion? I'll admit, I'm never sure. Perhaps imagination, nothing more. And now I hear a gentle tapping, or maybe even a steely rapping. Kanye, is that you? Or perhaps nothing, a whisper, like a wave upon the shore. Once again, the rings are intertwined, a deep, dark mystery for the mind, but just as suddenly we find they melt apart like rings of smoke. How strange these rings of yore. And now we take a ring so plain, add to it one again. Sorry, that sort of rhymes. Two rings, simple, charming, elegant, and more. And to these, we add a third. And without a single word, they take flight, much like a bird. Linking, midair galore. Which has never been done before. And now for those of you with dispositions who lend themselves to grand suspicions, these rings will assemble in much the same grand manner as before. Take the ring, hold it at 5 o'clock and 7 o'clock right in your hands. Hold it just like that. Watch carefully. One, two. And now this part's a bit contingent, and for those whose gaze is stringent, may notice copyright infringement. Disney's lawyer's pretty sure. But now the rings start to reverse. As if under ancient curse, the rings themselves start to disperse, till all is as it was before, except for this chain of four. A chain so lovely to behold, another mystery to unfold as the bottom rises through its brothers, two, three, and four. Then on again and down it tells, until at last they passed, it lies bottommost once more. And now the ends they interlink to form a square, the end, I think. But curiouser and curiouser with just one twist, no more. Suddenly it interfaces, linked in 16 different places. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16 different places. But just as quickly it erases, two on two, and then again, the chain of four. And now the rings, they come alive, for as I add ring number five, a tousle and a tassel, and it's different than before. Five linking rings, no less, no more. Ba, 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 ba. No Winter Olympics fans? Okay. Now, before I end this brief vacation, ring number six, a new sensation, and it's longer than ever before. But now the rings start to collect, to challenge once again my intellect. For five on one is not the same as we have had before. Which lends me to this new decision. Perhaps there is some small incision, quite unseen to human vision, or perhaps as big as a door, for this steely mass to penetrate. Five linking rings, no less, no more. But now before I leave, I have one task. That is to cleave these rings from one another. Ring number one begins the score, followed through by ring number two. Ring number three follows one and two. We're halfway there, just three to do. Ring number four. Ring number four. Well, perhaps later. Or nevermore. A mystery throughout the ages to baffle scientists and sages, for as the last ring disengages, all is as it was before. And thus we end our tale of solid rings, silver rings, forever free, forevermore.
Well, you guys have been fantastic. I just want to thank you, both ladies and gentlemen, and those that haven't determined their gender at this point. It's been so wonderful for you to join us. There's really only one thing left for us to do, and that's the closing number. So please welcome back Scott Alexander.
Thanks, everybody. Well, you know, It's been 6 years. It's been a good run. I've had a good time. And I've seen many familiar faces who have come back over the years. And I really appreciate you joining us. Really appreciate you being here. I appreciate all of you folks who got it and laughed at the jokes. We hope you had a good time. We hope you learned a lot of good magic along the way. But as it's often said, all good things must come to an end. And this must come to an end too. So check this out. I just wanted to say thanks for the memories of puns that were perverse. Some jokes were even worse, and bits that could have been better if we bothered to rehearse. How lovely it was. Thanks for the memories, those songs I'd serenade, the references we made, the hours that I spent with you instead of getting laid. How lovely it was. We who could laugh over big things. Some were people, some were slight things. I wonder if we did the right things. Oh well, that's life, I guess. Got no regrets. So thanks for the memories. Confetti on the floor, and fog machines galore, and crappy choreography that was pretty much piss poor. But thank you so much. We'll say goodbye with a highball. Cheers to those who we jumped on. But it's an honor to be dumped on. You know it's true, we all love you. So thanks for the memories. It's we're out of funny bits. It's time to call it quits. Plus, I ate at Taco Bell and I think I've got the shits. Thanks for the memories. I hope you always knew I did this all for you. And I sincerely hope that all your magic dreams come true. So thank you. It's been an honor and a privilege. Merry Christmas, everybody. Yep. Definitely shit my pants.
Hey. Say goodnight, Scott.
Good night, Scott. Thank you all very much. Thank you for supporting Live Magic. Ho, ho, ho.